Welcome to the 27th meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Before we start, I want to put on record our thanks to the Estonian MPs and the organisations and officials who met with us during our short fact-finding visit to Tallinn last week. There's a lot for us to learn from Estonia's success story in relation to digitalisation and public service reform, and we will draw on these learnings as we continue our pre-budget scrutiny. I also want to thank our clerking team for their first-class organisation and preparation for the visit, making sure we met the right people at the right time, ensuring the visits went smoothly and that we were all adequately fed and watered. We will publish a summary note of the visit in due course. Moving on to today's meeting, the first item on our agenda is to continue taking evidence on managing Scotland's public finances, a strategic approach. Therefore, welcome to the meeting Councillor Katie Hagman, Resources Spokesperson from COSLA, Jamie Robertson, Chair, CIPFA Directors of Finance, Malcolm Burr, Chief Executive, Cormorlane and Island Shire, and David Robertson, Chief Executive, Scottish Borders Council. And I'd like to thank you all for your written submissions. I have to say the COSLA one was quite exceptional, 171 paragraphs and some 40 pages. That made for a very interesting Sunday. We had around 90 minutes for the session. If witnesses like to be brought into discussion at any point, please indicate to clerks and I can then call you. So I suppose I'm going to start with that COSLA report. As well as a very detailed report, Katie, you've put in your report a wee summary, and one of the things that you've mentioned in the summary, and indeed frequently throughout the document, is, and I quote, the need to provide adequate, sustainable and flexible funding for local government. So I'm just wondering if you can expand on that, because it is a rather vague statement, and I'm just wondering if you can give us a wee bit of a steer on where you feel local government funding should sit with regard to the forthcoming Scottish budget.
Thank you, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to come and speak to you all this morning. I think in terms of that opening statement from yourself, it's really important that we do have sustainable public sector services and funding, and certainly that was one of the key cornerstones of the Verity House Agreement. So that was in the joint agreement between local government and Scottish Government. I think, you know, we're all well aware how challenging the financial situation is facing all of our communities, all of our citizens, all of the services that we're providing, and therefore it is absolutely important, it's vital, that we do look to the future and actually ensure sustainability is at the heart of what we're doing. And certainly, I think from local government's point of view, we're at the very heart of our communities, and our citizens, our residents are all looking for that cohesive package, so to speak, in providing the very best opportunities for those who are, you know, really suffering from terms of poverty, and certainly our young people for attainment and such things, and also our elderly population who are looking for sustainable services there. So if we want to move forward cohesively together, we do need to have some really challenging conversations, and we need to make sure that we are actually providing the very best we can within the limited resources that we have got.
Right, but that doesn't tell me what those resources should be. So what do you think the Scottish Government should do with regard to local government settlement? Obviously, you're looking for it to be increased, I mean, from reading the report, quite significantly in a number of areas. We'll go on to other things like, prevention, taxes in a minute, but I'm just trying to get a wee bit more detail on what this means. And I have to say, I'm going to be moving to yourself, Mr. Robertson, as well, because you've also said that, you've also talked about the same issue, regarding the addressing shared priorities, unlocking both potential and the best outcomes for communities requires adequate funding from central government. So after Katie, I'll move on to yourself, and then others can come in as they so wish.
So I think one thing that is mentioned throughout the report, and it is a long-standing position of COSLA, is we very much would like to see multi-year budgets. I think that would give us some sort of certainty. It would allow us planning for the future, with planning for our workforces, planning for our third sector partners that we absolutely are key in delivering some of the services. So multi-year settlements are certainly an ambition for local government that we would like to see going forward. I think there's also an opportunity to empower local government further. There is a commitment in looking at council tax reform and other ways of revenue raising, and certainly that's something that we'd like to progress, and actually ensuring that that can go forward is vital again for that sustainability going forward. I think there is opportunities for local revenue raising. The visitor levy is a good example of that. The new proposed infrastructure levy is somewhere that we can possibly explore, and certainly just last week leaders in COSLA were happy to support the exploration of that levy as well. So there's a couple of examples there of what could support local government and ways of working with Scottish Government in delivering for the future.
Clearly you're not prepared to say what you feel the settlement should be from the Scottish Government though, and obviously what this is, we're trying to pin that down, because if we're going to make recommendations to Scottish ministers about the Scottish local government financial settlement, it's very difficult if local government aren't telling us what they feel they require in terms of the amount of budget going forward next year.
I'm quite happy to share, and I think it is in the report that we submitted, but certainly the Accounts Commission have estimated £780 million gap for 26-27. So if you're looking for a figure, that's an independent figure from the Accounts Commission that hopefully should help in terms of your recommendations going forward.
That is actually very helpful. So over the next 2 years, you're looking for a £780 million uplift. That'd be fair to say that. Okay, that's great. That's very helpful. Now, Mr Robertson, you also talked about adequate funding, but you also go on to say the level of taxation which is collected, set and spent locally is lower in Scotland than international comparators. And you make the argument, which Katie's just kind of made, basically regarding, that there should be more levers, etc. Now, I'm not really sure what you mean. If you mean that there should be a higher proportion of local government spend should be raised by local government itself directly, I think you are saying that. But you also seem to be saying that the amount of revenue collected should also increase substantially. So what you're basically saying is that as well as having more powers, you should be able to impose greater taxes on the public, which I'm sure wouldn't be necessarily very popular with people. You know, so, for example, we hear a lot about council tax revaluation, and I think there's some sympathy with that in the committee, but not if it's seen as a way of just grabbing more money from local people rather than a rebalancing. So where do you stand on that?
Thanks, Chair. I mean, we're arguing, I think, in our evidence to the committee that we need, you know, adequate, sustainable finances. And where we're sitting at the moment, certainly in terms of my council, 80% of our revenue comes directly from the Scottish Government. 20% of our net revenue is levied locally through council tax. And we would like to see more money being raised by the council and determined locally. There are a number of levers that we're seeing coming into the system in terms of things like the visitor levy, discussions over an infrastructure levy, these kind of tools being made available to local government. We completely accept that taxes are not popular, but the reality is that we need an adequate, sustainable level of funding to support public services that people value. And what we've seen in the last few years is we haven't seen real terms increases in terms of council tax funding. We're having to make significant reductions year on year in order to balance the books. And we think that one way to do that is to try to raise more to balance that equation is to raise more revenue locally.
Right. Okay. So basically, you are saying that basically local people and, you know, and the Scottish border should be paying more in taxes. Is that what you're saying, really?
What we're saying
only going to the council instead of Holyrood or Westminster.
Well, we're not saying that the people on the border should be paying more taxes. What we're saying is that the tax base has to be appropriate, and that the revenue funding that local councils have has to be appropriate to fund local services. And you know, that's essentially, I think, the position that we would adopt.
Okay. I should really call you all by your first names, I think, given we've got two Robertsons in the panel, make things like
no relations
confusing. Jamie, what's SEAPFA's view on this? I mean, one of the things about visitor levy, I think there's broad support for that, but there's issues, for example, it's great for Edinburgh and indeed Katie's Dumfries and Galloway region, I would imagine, but I don't know that North Lanarkshire or Clackmannanshire or some other local authorities are necessarily going to generate additional funding. So does that cause a kind of funding imbalance across Scottish local authorities if Edinburgh could be getting 30, 40, 50 million pounds a year and, you know, North Lanarkshire a few hundred thousand or even less?
I think it's a very difficult conversation in terms of the overall level of funding. However, visitor levies are seeking to generate income to offset and additional costs that are incurred as part of, you know, cruise ships, etc., or visitors, and to invest in the infrastructure. I think it's proportionate based on the various activities of each of the councils. But I think, you know, in terms of, you know, some of the key asks around the Verity House Agreement, I think it's really important that we align the asks of the Verity House Agreement to the financial sustainability of each of the councils. And I suppose it's about that, ensuring that there is empowerment for local government to raise local levies and empower local government to, say, raise levies to invest in climate change or to in early intervention. So I suppose there, in terms of the specific visitor levies, there's going to be differences across all of Scotland. However, that kind of overall flexibility and empowering of local authorities can take a number of different options that will enable councils to thrive and to support joint ambitions with the Scottish Government.
Malcolm, you know, the Western Isles, if I can use its English name, is not a necessarily very prosperous area. How would the people in the Western Isles feel about additional taxes to being raised locally to pay for services?
It's a very interesting question, and we've done a ward-based consultation recently where there was not the disquiet. There wasn't, of course, a triumphant welcome for new taxation, but there was a deep understanding that revenue has to come from somewhere, and if there is no prospect of it coming from Scottish Government or through traditional sources, then we must do something ourselves. My own council area, like many of rural Highlands and Islands and probably the rest of rural Scotland, lacks other options. We can't outsource services because there is no market to outsource to. I can't share services physically across 27 miles of sea. So we are, and you know my main suggestion for what we do, and I've pursued it for years, is serious public service reform, and perhaps we'll come on to that. But in terms of tax, there's an understanding that we have to look to our own resources, and that may include above inflation rises in council tax. That may include as much freedom as using the freedoms we have, and I think we need more to build on what David has said, to raise our own revenue. That is not going to be transformational, though, in an area of 27,000 people.
So in terms of local taxation, we know about cruise ship levies and visitor levies and, you know, even workforce parking and things like that. None of them are going to have a massive impact, I would have thought, in terms of local authority finances. So, kind of, Malcolm, what other areas would you feel that you would like local government, because you talked about reform there, if we were to form local government finance, what other areas do you feel that there should be control over? Local sales tax, for example, what do you feel? Where would you feel?
I think the discussions on fiscal framework should be as wide as they can be, and yes, should look at models of funding local government elsewhere. It is though also about structure. I hate to come back to structure. You know, if our statutory position is as it is, if we're not able to undertake serious public service reform in a way that will free up resources, then and revenue is not coming from elsewhere, then yes, we must look at revenue raising in a way we haven't before, which is largely council tax and charges and such individual things like visitor levies, which will be welcome, I should add, but they will just fill holes which have reduced over the years. I feel obliged to draw your attention to the Spice State of Local Government briefing, which, you know, shows my own council's reductions over the last 10 years have been in the order of, in real terms, 14%. Mm-hmm. You know, that leaves gaps to be filled.
OK, and David, you heard at the beginning that we had a trip to Estonia last week to look at what they're doing in terms of their digitisation of public services. Is that an area? You know, Estonia did this, incidentally, because after independence from the Soviet Union, it only had €130 million budget for the whole country. And they couldn't afford to set up offices in rural towns. They had to do everything somehow differently, and they ended up doing it digitally as a way of... So is that kind of way of service delivery something that the Borders is looking at?
It is something that we're investing in very heavily with the resources that we have, Chair. I mean, we've done significant pieces of work, for example, in terms of our care services, where we've provided mobile technology to all our care staff. And our estimate of that is that improved the efficiency of the service, i.e. the number of care visits that people could provide by around 16%. So our 400 in-house care staff were all able to be scheduled and rostered online using a mobile device. And that also improved the quality of the service because we were able to limit the number of people who were in and out of those requiring care houses, which was also a benefit. We're investing very heavily in our customer services technology in terms of online payments and feedback and fault reporting and all these kind of things. We've transformed our council core systems, HR, payroll, finance, procurement. We've done all that, and we've tried to implement mobile technology. iPad mobile technology in terms of our schools to deliver better educational outcomes. So it's an area that we see huge potential in. It requires huge investment, but in terms of delivering savings going forward, we think that's absolutely an area of prime focus for the organisation. And we've done a huge amount of work in that area over the last years with lots more to do.
Katie, Estonia's only 1.3 million people, 79 municipalities, whereas we've got, you know, 5.4 million people in 32 municipalities. So they're of about a tenth of our population. So they've got one connected digital system, X-Road. Is COSLA working with local authorities to ensure compatibility and systems to ensure that the savings that are made can be made at a national level and therefore benefit local authorities directly?
So the digital office has come under the umbrella of COSLA just recently, and certainly there's a huge amount of work being done across all local authorities through the work of the digital office. I sit jointly with Minister Ivan McKee in looking at digital strategy, so there is also that joint work happening with local government and Scottish Government. I am aware, you know, there was a critical report that came out, you know, calling out both Scottish Government and local authorities that we weren't doing enough on that, and certainly there has to be a refocus within that space. You know, I'm absolutely committed to that, as is COSLA leaders. It's a subject that does come up. I think one of the other opportunities that we're looking at is the advancement of AI and how we can utilise that for the future. But obviously that brings concerns from some as well. So how do we ensure that we harness new technology, but also in a safe way that can support our communities and also bring our communities along with us? I think, you know, there's lots of savings that could potentially be made if everything was moved online, but we have to be really mindful that many of our communities might be excluded from the digital world. So therefore, you know, that face-to-face customer services is something that, you know, many across our communities really value, and actually we want to ensure that nobody is left behind and nobody is left disempowered as a result. But no, absolutely, there is work that has to be done. There's work that is being done, I think, as outlined by David, especially across the care sector. It's absolutely vital that we move forward, but And you know, there is absolutely room for improvement, and we will continue to work towards that.
And will the causeless system, I'm heartened to hear that, you know, engaging with all 32 local authorities on this to ensure we've got a kind of, you know, the ability to have one system that can operate across the country. But would the NHS be linked into such a system? Because I think, quoting Estonia again, I think one of the advantages of their system is it connects all public, the entire public sector. And you talked about care, so obviously health and care, there's a very strong interaction there.
So there's not one system that all local authorities are using. I know that there's an ambition to get to those kind of systems. Certainly there's opportunities to take forward across planning, for example, seems a good area to start with. I think, you know, there is that joint strategy with Scottish Government and local government, but taking it back one stage within local government, we have the Digital Partnership Board, and within that we have various partners that come together from Scotland Excel, from the Improvement Service, from CMIS, and that's to ensure that as a local authority, you know, supporting local authorities, we're bringing in all our partners so we can have that one cohesive voice. And there is work being done within that space, but as I say, I think there's definitely more work that needs to be done going forward.
And an area you've also highlighted again frequently throughout the document has been preventative spend and early intervention. You've said there needs to be a refocus on prevention and early intervention spend. Now more than ever, there needs to be investment in upstream services that help to prevent problems rather than focusing spend on responding to them. And I think we would agree with that. And as I mentioned to other witnesses and other panels, from 2011 to 2016, in that Parliament, John Swinney allocated £500 million to try and embed preventive spend. But the difficulty was there was no corresponding disinvestment in programmes that were providing less value for money, shall we say. So what is COSLA doing to try and ensure that we move down the road of disinvesting in areas which provide less value for money in order to focus on the areas that provide the most?
So I think, it's a really challenging one to look at, because we're not at the stage of doing that preventative spend. So until we are actually at that point, it becomes, it's almost impossible to stop delivering the services where you're catching people after they have fallen, so to speak. So, you know, it is really challenging. You know, councils have a legal responsibility to set a balanced budget, and every single year some really awful decisions are having to be taken. And next year, when councils are setting their budget, when they're setting their council tax, that's not going to be any different. I'm aware of leaders up and down the country who are grappling with proposals that officers are bringing forward in order to try and balance budgets next year. So at this point, it's not really possible to say that we can identify areas that, you know, we're okay with, because we've been cutting for the last 10 years. We're actually at the point where any cuts going forward are going to have huge detrimental impacts on our community. But that doesn't mean to say that we shouldn't be investing, as I said, or as the report says, in upstream services. And, you know, Public Health Scotland have done a huge amount of work to demonstrate the value of preventative spend and how much that will actually save going forward. But we are at that difficult point of, when do you stop, you know, spending on the here and now to invest for the future? And as I said at the start, in local government, we're right on the front line services. We're holding our communities, you know, right in front of us. They're there. So to look people in the eye and say, actually, we're going to stop doing these things that are really making a huge difference to you because we're going to try and stop that in the future, it becomes an impossible task.
Okay. Jamie, in relation to that, one of the issues that again comes out in the document quite forcefully is flexibility. So, for example, on page 19 of the document, in paragraph 70, there's a really interesting graph that follows it that says that in actual fact, since 2010-11, there have been significant increase in education spend, 21.2% real terms. Adult social care has went up 29.4%, looked after children 17.5%, but that's been matched by huge reductions in other areas, 35% in street cleaning, 27% in tourism, culture and leisure 20% and 26.6% in planning, for example. There's a couple of others there. And one of the things that's in the document is that you talk about Scotland having a significantly lower pupil teacher ratio than the rest of the UK, 13.2 children per teacher compared to 18 in England, but we don't have better educational outcomes. So do you feel that local authorities, I know you're, I think you're going to say, but this is for the record because I've actually got talking here, but do you feel, how important do you feel is that local authorities should have the flexibility to decide for themselves how many teachers, for example, employ and whether or not that money should be able to be deployed elsewhere, if required?
I think that analysis is really crucial to the understanding the differential between what is effectively ring-fence spend within local authorities. So we have teachers is effectively ring-fence because we have the pupil-teacher ratios. We have health and social care partnerships where there's directed spend for the health and social care partnerships, which comes out in the finance circular every year. So what we're actually, what that paragraph is speaking to is the disproportionate effects on other services as a result of having those protected or directed kind of spend areas. I suppose the flexibility for pupil-teacher ratios is something that is incredibly political, and I'll maybe defer to Councillor Hagman in terms of a response. But equally, what we can see is that the efficacy of bringing children into schools and making ensuring that children are present in schools in order then to be fit, ready, fed and active and ready to learn is not something that is necessarily part of the pupil-teacher ratios, but it's the ability to invest in additional support teachers, the ability to invest in officers to get children into the school environment who are fed. And I think that's where some of the positive benefits can accrue in terms of ensuring that there's better outcomes and the outcomes for children are much improved. So I suppose in terms of having an artificial ratio around that, it doesn't provide flexibility for councils, and it provides a material sum in our overall budget, which necessarily, when you're looking at financial gaps of £700 million, needs to be borne by other services. And where those services, my own service in Eastern Bartonshire Council is a £3 million service, and we have a £10 million budget cut. So, you know, necessarily that would result in all of finance being removed from the system. So it's about priorities, it's about balance, but it's also about that flexibility that enables us to meet those shared aspirations with the Scottish Government.
Yeah, I mean, there's actually a lot of pressure on MSPs about teacher numbers because I think it's called for 3,500 more teachers. Which, and we were all lobbied about that earlier this year, as I recall, and we get frequent calls within the Chamber for more teachers, despite the falling number of children we have in our schools. But just what's the impact yourself, Malcolm, on your local authority of the kind of the straitjacket of ring fencing? Something which we, if you may recall, those of us who were here in the days of the historic Concordat in November 2007, the Scottish Government kind of seek to eliminate then, but has gradually crept back over the last 15 years or so.
Yes, I too have been around for that long, and I'm a great fan. I was a great fan of the Concordat approach, and I think it should be revived personally between government and each council. But yes, it is hard to be told, and rightly, to be radical, to be transformative, to be collaborative, and at the same time to be told here is one group of employees, which have to be protected absolutely in terms of numbers. I think that's a strange message, if it is not linked to the evidence about outcomes. I mean, we have always tried to protect our teacher numbers, and our teacher numbers are inflated locally, of course, because of small schools in small islands. So it's probably slightly higher than the average should be. I think last year we were on the line. But we have to look at there are other ways of doing education, and eSchool is one of them. The COVID pandemic showed there is a place for online education as well. And I think the teaching profession can be perhaps resistant to that, But no area should be exempt from the same scrutiny and the same proper evaluation of alternatives than any other. I don't think we can afford to do that. That applies to other aspects of ring fencing as well.
And this is a really important issue, obviously, flexibility. David, how is it impacting on borders?
I suppose the reality behind ring fencing is the more that the budget is directed to specific areas, and the more it's targeted on things like teacher numbers, the less flexibility we have elsewhere to deliver local services. And the impact we're seeing is in terms of quality of life services, in terms of communities, people are noticing. The potholes in the roads, the grass cutting, the area maintenance, the general quality of the built environment, and their ability to access, library services, etc. So all these things, the more we ring fence and protect and direct specific areas of spend, the less flexibility we have in terms of other areas of the budget. And we're really now looking in terms of our flexibility at around about 20% of our overall spend to make all the kind of savings that we have to make through our central support costs and our area-based services, because all the other aspects of the budget are essentially being tied up either in repaying capital debt or employing teachers or employing other groups of staff. So our flexibility is being constrained year upon year in terms of what we're doing. And we're increasingly seeing that we're being forced into making reductions, which we wouldn't ideally wish to make, but unfortunately, to ensure the authorities remain financially sustainable, those are the types of areas that we're going into. So we're closing public toilets, we're reducing our grass maintenance, we're reducing our the types of things that people are noticing.
The point of it is in terms of politics of it is that the Scottish Government take the view that they get blamed if teacher numbers fall. So if they give local authorities flexibility to change teacher numbers and there's fewer teachers, then they get to blame it rather than the actual local authority takes a decision, despite the local government, having its own level of democratic accountability. And I know you're smiling, Mr. Roberts, because you know exactly that that's the case.
We firmly believe as an organisation in employing as many teachers as we possibly can. We want to make sure those teachers are properly resourced and they're properly supported. We don't believe the focus should be simply about the number of teachers we're employing, particularly as you've indicated, Chair, the number of pupils that we're actually educating is falling, and we have significant challenges of the numbers of buildings that we're currently operating, certainly in the borders. The reality behind this is that it's head teachers who run schools. They run schools through DSM schemes. We say they're empowered to deliver and manage and manage their schools. And we think it's right that those head teachers should therefore be allowed to employ the number of teachers that they can within they require within the overall resource envelope. And those teachers have to teach in good quality buildings with appropriate resources, supported by a range of professional staff. And if we simply focus on the number of teachers that we have, which seems to be the kind of polarised debate that is going on, then we don't think that's the right focus in terms of education.
Yeah, and teachers could also be used peripatetically. But I'll move on to my final question, because colleagues are keen to come in. And it's just about capital spend. Katie, you've talked about the challenges to housing supply and the delivery of homelessness services, and in paragraph 63 you state in bold, to mitigate against the development of poverty and improve health outcomes, local government needs sustainable investment in affordable housing. Now again, what does that actually mean in cash terms, and how can the Scottish Government do that when it's faced with a 20% reduction in capital over 5 years?
So I think it's a valid point, and certainly local government is very mindful that the budget has been cut for Scottish Government. We're not immune to that information. But certainly, again, there's, I think, up to 10 local authorities currently have declared housing emergencies. We have rightly welcomed a lot of people seeking asylum in the UK and refugees, and then we have issues across our own local authorities. There's issues with RAC. There's a whole host of problems that local authorities are grappling with in terms of our capital budget. Clearly, we want to invest for the future, and I think, you know, there was mention there about the school estate as well, and where we're wanting to deliver the very best educational experience for our young people, we want to invest in our schooling as well. So, you know, ultimately, we do have borrowing abilities within local government, but we have to be mindful that anything we borrow will have to be paid back, so that then affects our revenue going forward. In terms of the specific numbers, I'd probably turn to one of my colleagues here with me. Jamie's indicating, so we'll bring him in. But, you know, it is vital that we look to the future. I think, you know, we are in election cycles where we're having to make decisions year on year, but some of the investment that we're making will have long-term ramifications, and sometimes brave decisions need to be taken, especially if we're looking to support our local economies and provide the very best opportunities. There is also got to be a realistic understanding of that term transformation and how that affects our estate and where we have capital investment. We have a huge amount of buildings, some of which we may not need, some of which there might be use for within the community, and where there's community opportunities, certainly local authorities are supporting community asset transfers to then support other projects that perhaps the council isn't best placed to take forward. So, you know, there's a whole load of areas that we can look at, but ultimately, you know, we do need that capital investment in order to provide for the future.
Jamie, local authorities actually have greater flexibility with borrowing than the Scottish Government because it's got prudential borrowing, and there's been a significant reduction in terms of borrowing from 1.23 billion in 2019-20 down to 690 million in 21-22, with a slight upkick in to 820 million in 22-23. I don't have the figures for last year in your document. Because the document says council find themselves in a position of having to place greater reliance on borrowing as a source of capital funding to sustain and invest in their infrastructure to meet the needs and priorities of communities and boost local economies. So clearly the reliance on this is greater. Do you feel that this is going to continue to be the case, that borrowing is going to have to play a bigger role, or is it going to be, as we've seen the last 3 or 4 years, a reduction in borrowing across local authorities?
I think as Councillor Hagman set out, consequential impact of borrowing is that it increases your overall revenue expenditure, because obviously debt has to be repaid, and there's both a principal and an interest element of that debt. When Council set their capital budgets, the Audit Scotland have identified in their budget setting report that increased recourse is to borrowing, and that's in order to deliver good quality assets that deliver shared outcomes, that deliver Council priorities. However, with increasing interest rates and increasing build costs, you know, that has the potential to be unsustainable. And as directors of finance, we're set by the burdens of the Prudential Code. So we need to ensure that all borrowing is affordable, sustainable and prudent. We are, the local government benchmark framework has indicated that debt as a proportion of revenue has decreased in recent years. And that's as a result of specific interventions such as the fiscal flexibilities, etc. However, overall debt is increasing and will continue to increase to deliver those priorities. However, there will come a point where that becomes unsustainable, and each council may set a cap in terms of what its overall affordability is. I suppose what I was indicating to come in there, and I wanted to give you a live example. Eastern Bartonshire Council are looking to invest in affordable housing, and we've done some work in a 15-unit accommodation for affordable housing purposes, and the individual cost of each unit within that affordable housing programme is £420,000 for each unit, and that would require to be either borrowed through the housing revenue account and ultimately repaid by tenants, and that includes the funding towards net carbon heating, silver building regulation standards, automatic fire suppression systems, digitally enabled households and EV charging points. So the cost of developing affordable housing is significant. So the council, in order to meet all the obligations, it is a significant investment for councils, and obviously that's for affordable housing. I think councils, the overall debt repayments have been suppressed in previous years as a result of those actions that Section 95 officers have recommended as prudent and affordable within the loans fund repayments, the service concession arrangements. However, this is something that is a significant risk should councils continue to invest without recourse to the savings that are required to generate reductions elsewhere. So a £10 million financial gap and £2-5 million worth of additional debt to create capital borrowing is financially unsustainable in the short, medium and long term.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to open up the session. First colleague to ask questions will be Michael, to follow by Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Councillor Hagman, it's 9 weeks until the budget announcement in Holyrood. Can I ask how the discussions are going?
Yes, so in terms of the early engagement, there is a commitment from Scottish Government, and that has been repeated in many forums. I have got dates in my diary to meet with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance. In terms of the fiscal framework, I know that there's been a lot of discussion, and I think there has been expressed disappointment that we don't have a fiscal framework right now. That's not to say that there hasn't been a huge amount of work and a huge amount of learning on both sides, both from Scottish Government looking at local government and local government's understanding with Scottish Government budgets. So there has been a huge amount of background work going forward. Leaders are being kept up to date with that. There's going to be a substantive update at the next COSLA leaders meeting as well. So there is, you know, very much an open dialogue. Clearly, I've only been in this post 2.5 years, so I can't compare to what happened previous to me taking up this position. But certainly from my experience, there has been that open dialogue. And certainly throughout the pay negotiations, for example, I did have regular updates and contact with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance.
2.5 years, and this will be your third time in this process. Is that right? Or second time, perhaps?
Let's say third time.
Is it the same as previous years, or have you got a better understanding of in terms of the strategic approach that they're taking this year?
So my reflection is that there's been a lot more dialogue. I think the proof will be in what actually happens going forward. We can talk, you know, for endlessly, but actually, you know, we need to know what's going to happen in terms of the budget. And as you say, we're coming up to those crucial dates.
So 9 weeks out, I mean, I understand that the budget, both in terms of the budget that's set at the UK government level, and then will inform very substantially what happens afterwards. But the reality of that, that will be kind of percentage points of difference. The Institute for Fiscal Studies has said in recent weeks that the government should be using this budget strategically to have conversations with local government and other service providers to take long-term decisions. I kind of feel like 9 weeks out, if there were strategic decisions to be taken about some of the things that you call for in your document, about what the government should be clear about, what should be stopped as policy, which should be what the focus should be. Is that the substance of the conversations? Do you think this will be a strategic budget?
I would hope that it's a strategic budget. I mean, certainly in terms of the dates, we've been made aware that the local government circular will not be published until the 12th of December. So that is quite late as well. But, you know, these are the dates, and some of these are out with the control of both Scottish Government and local government, because it comes to data points that we need to be working with. I think, you know, in terms of multi-year budgets, it's a discussion that has been brought up, and certainly the Cabinet Secretary has been open and said that they will be looking at the settlement from Westminster, and certainly where there is opportunities that she will be taking those where possible.
To us, that the medium-term financial strategy will come alongside the spending review, which will happen in the spring. So those multi-year budgets, I think, is probably for that point. But this, in terms of decisions to be taken this year, have you told the Cabinet Secretary the things that you think you should stop doing?
Absolutely. I mean, I think the comments earlier about teacher numbers, for example, you know, that is a well-trailed argument that we have been making. I mean, the pay bill for teachers is our single biggest spend, around £4 billion a year. So, you know, where we have got falling pupil numbers and where we are fully committed to reducing the poverty-related attainment gap, focusing purely on teacher numbers when in fact there's a whole host of other services that local government are providing. You know, so those types of conversations are happening, and certainly we would hope that they're reflected in decisions going forward.
There seems to me, in terms of the submission you've made to us for today, very useful, as the Convener says, that there's a real frustration, I think, in terms of some of the short-term decisions that are being taken. So it says Scottish Government policy and spend decisions that run counter to the Verity House Agreement, such as the council tax freeze and maintain teacher numbers, prevent councils from achieving better outcomes for the constituents. I mean, that is really about ad hoc, off-on-the-hoof policy decisions that are taken out with the cycle of negotiation. So do you have confidence that this year we won't see that kind of approach to budgeting from the government? Are they saying to you that actually there's a long-term approach?
So I think we are making the case as best we can. Ultimately, these will be decisions for Scottish Government to take and for ministers to grapple with in terms of the budget going forward. I think the example of the council tax freeze, yes, it was funded at 5%, but there were local authorities that were budgeting for more than 5%, so therefore, in effect, it wasn't fully funded. And certainly that's a policy that has been spoken of greatly, and certainly every opportunity, you know, that there should be no council tax freeze going forward is being made at every opportunity by every leader, and I would imagine by every spokesperson as well for COSLA.
One of the recurring themes that we've had over recent months is, particularly from the Cabinet Secretary, has been about the challenge of public sector pay and meeting the public sector pay bill. Obviously, we have a significantly higher proportion of the working public in Scotland who are working in public services. We also have already a higher level of wage. So, you know, a 5% increase on our pay bill is significantly higher than a 5% increase on a pay bill for the rest of the country. And that's one of the key issues I think the Cabinet Secretary is grappling with. Well, I would just maybe ask the whole panel where you see these trade-offs between pay rises and headcount. I mean, you've used the teacher issues as an example. Is that a choice that councils are having to make? I mean, you anticipate that you will have to make. Mr. Robertson?
In terms of balancing the budget, in terms of the balancing the budget, yes, that is a trade-off. I mean pay is our largest cost, and we're having to manage our workforce appropriately in line with the services we have to deliver and the resources we have to deliver them. And therefore, what we are doing increasingly is holding vacancies in other areas. We're not filling posts. We're reorganising our services. We're bringing things together in order to try and sustain areas of the workforce, like the number of teachers that we're told that we need to employ. And we have, you know, so we're making changes in terms of our strategic workforce planning in areas where we can deliver those, bringing in new technology to not have to recruit as many people as we had before. But the reality behind many council services is that they require people. They require carers, they require refuse collection drivers, they require operatives in the street, and we're increasingly creaking, I think, in terms of our workforce planning. And if we do restrict large areas of the staffing budget and determine you need to employ this input, this number of teachers, then that does have an impact in terms of the number of social workers and care staff and all the rest of it that we can ultimately employ.
Please, Mr. Barr.
Thank you. It's an exercise that can only go on for so long. I have to be very clear about that. My own council has gone from around 1,900 employees in 2010 to around just under 1,600 now, a loss of 262 full-time posts. That's in an island community. Now, that's around 400 people's jobs if you take full-time and part-time. And as David has said, it is not possible to keep on doing it without reducing statutory services to a level that everyone around this table, I think, would find unacceptable. And that is the place we are having to go now in our thinking. It is not an exercise that can go on and on and on. The budget is, to a certain extent, sustained by vacancies at the moment, and that's not healthy either.
I concur with my colleagues' points there, and I think it's worth noting. I think it's in the submission as well. You know, councils will make assumptions on pay, and that will generate over their medium-term financial strategy. So we'll make assumptions on pay over a number of different years, and I think part of the challenge, and it's recognised in the report, is the impact of pay expectations exceeding those assumptions that have previously been budgeted for councils. And certainly for my own council, that has precipitated the issue of a non-essential spend and a business critical spend memo being issued by the chief executive to curtail spend in year. We're on a vacancy control, we're on a vacancy freeze, our recruitment processes are slowed, it's essential posts only, and that's having significant impact on the delivery of statutory services within my own function, financial statements, accounts, all these things that are required to support obviously frontline services and the delivery of council services.
So it sounds to me like we're reaching the end of the road in terms of headcount reduction before it affects legal requirements. Is that correct?
Affects legal requirements and the capacity of councils to provide community leadership as well as providing services.
Okay. There's other issues regarding tax reform. The Premier touched on some of it: revaluation, extra bans, changes to the reduction schemes, and so on, which you all cover in your submission. That's ongoing, and you've said that you want to see that work accelerated in the coming months. I mean, that's 9 weeks out. Will any of that be done for the budget?
Confirm that we have got meetings in the diary getting arranged for the continuation of the working group, but it is just that, it is a working group. We're not at the point of any announcements as such being made, and I think there has been a slowdown of that work due to a change of ministerial positions, and that is the reality that we're working on within. But certainly COSLA and leaders are committed and want to see that kind of reform being taken place across council.
So it doesn't sound that realistically, 9 weeks out from a budget, these are long term, this has gone on for a decade and more, that we're going to see proposals come forward for the government to change this side of the ledger.
So I don't have any proposals at this point, okay, but so no, I have to say there is still that commitment to work together.
Okay, and you mentioned before the fiscal framework, that was meant to be agreed by June 2023. Do you think we'll have a fiscal framework in place in 9 weeks' time?
So I think what the wording of the Verity House agreement was to aspire to have a fiscal framework. It wasn't ever set in stone. Okay. But, you know...
Not met that aspiration, have
we haven't, but we are still working towards it in the same way that we haven't met the aspiration of £15 an hour for our local government workforce. You know, that was a request for our trade union partners, and certainly we agreed that we would work with Scottish Government on that. But, again, Scottish Government were very clear that the funding would have to flow from Westminster in order for that aspiration to be met.
There's no proposals on the table. You don't aspire to get this done in 9 weeks, do you? That would be too
we
serious.
Always aspire to reach our targets. I'm an optimist.
Can we be a little bit more pragmatic around it? Because we're trying to actually understand the restrictions of the budget and how that's going to work. I mean, realistically, I don't think anybody on the panel would say they think. I mean, could we have hands up for people who think that we're going to have a fiscal framework in 9 weeks' time?
What I would say is... It may not be complete, but there's a significant amount of work that has been done. And I think the understanding, as I said earlier, there's a far greater understanding from Scottish Government officials of what local government is facing. And equally, there has been learning from local government to understand the levers that Scottish Government are working in. So I think it's unfair to say that we're not going to make it and we've failed as such, because there has been significant progress made in that space. And just because we've not crossed the finish line doesn't mean that we haven't made significant progress down the road.
I would tend to disagree, Councillor Hagman, I have to say, in terms of we're going to see cuts to services, we're going to see the third year we've just had of chaotic in-year budget cuts that are affecting in terms of your ability and all services' ability to deliver outcomes for people in this country. We're going to see, by the sounds of things, very large increases in council tax. I mean, there are consequences to this not being done. And just the reality is whether it gets done, not whether there are meetings coming into the diary. I mean, this has gone on now for years. And we're being asked to see the government to take a strategic approach to the budget. And from all the evidence you've given us so far, it doesn't sound like, in the absence of, you know, I'm sure the diary secretaries are working very hard to get time in diaries, but it doesn't sound like there are any proposals on the table at all about anything strategic. Is that not the case?
So what I would say is we have been working in exceptional times, the cost of living crisis, there's also the rates of inflation, these have all had impacts, and certainly I think it's very easy to forget that we've lived through a pandemic and the ramifications of the pandemic are also being felt, and all those will affect the budget.
If I can interrupt, in your submission you say it's the choice of the government to increase spending out with the block grant allocations by £1 billion in other areas. That's a choice that the government has made. You're very critical of them in your very helpful submission, but now in the evidence we're hearing that actually this is, you know, the circumstances are different. You're telling us there are choices to be made, and what you're telling me today is that they're not making the strategic choices. They've not had any proposals on the table. We're 9 weeks out. Is that not the case?
So I think there's always political choices to be made, and certainly Scottish Government will make those. I'm here to present the evidence from local government. And certainly we are fully committed to working jointly together. We've been very clear on some of the nuances of where we want to go for. Teacher numbers is one example, being no freeze on council tax, the continuation of jointly working collaboratively in terms of that sustainable public service investment. You know, we've not mentioned at all our aspirations on net zero, but certainly we are committed to that. And that feeds into the earlier discussion about our capital spend. In order to meet our net zero targets, we absolutely need to accelerate those. It would be wonderful if there was a simple resolution to the budgets. Unfortunately, there's not, but certainly the evidence that we've provided, actually, I would hope, would give you some areas for exploration, and certainly that we've covered today in our evidence as well.
Yeah. Thanks, Kabir.
Thank you. Ross, before by John.
Thanks, Commissioner. Good morning. If I could just, in the first instance, just check with Councillor Hagman, the working group that you mentioned on local government finance reform, how many times has that met since the change of administration?
It's not met. We've got meetings in the diary being arranged now.
Right. Between all your written submissions and what's been mentioned this morning, it feels like there's not a lot of new ideas in terms of fiscal empowerment for councillors. So the infrastructure levy, that was agreed to in 2019 in the planning bill. The cruise ship levy was announced last year. Visitor levy has been passed by Parliament. What are the new proposals that local government is putting onto the table, adding to the agenda here? What are the new powers that you want to see that you will be seeking agreement from Scottish Government on?
So in terms of the infrastructure levy, this has only just been brought to local government in our last leaders' meeting. While it may have been on the agenda for Scottish Government, we've not as yet had that joint dialogue. So certainly that's one that local government is looking to explore. So it's not one that we've...
I just want to clarify there. So the infrastructure levy is a power from the 2019 Act. What we need to do now is pass the regulations to enable it before 2026, because those regulations have a sunset clause. My point here is that the idea, the concept of an infrastructure levy, that was agreed already, it was agreed in 2019, Parliament agreed to it when it put it into the Act. What I'm looking for are new proposals for new powers. Local government talks a lot about needing to be far more empowered to raise its own money. I agree with you absolutely. But what I'm really interested in hearing this morning is, what are the new proposals that you are putting on the table? What are the new powers that you want to see local government have?
So I've not got a set of proposals here today before you to say this is what we want to do. What I can say is that we are working across local authorities, we're working with our leaders, we're working with the likes of the improvement services, and certainly there are issues around our recruitment and retention and our workforce of the future. These are all opportunities that we're looking to develop in the future. In terms of, you know, examples of what we would like to do, that is a future discussion that we need to take forward in the working group exploring. I think people get very hung up on the fact that the title opens with council tax reform, but it actually has and other sources of local revenue raising. So, you know, that is an area that we need to explore further, and it's one that needs to have some more momentum going forward.
Do other colleagues have any proposals, anything that has been discussed within your local authorities, new, brand new powers that could be brought forward?
So from my authority's perspective, no. I think we're currently spending, you know, nationally over £13 billion in terms of local authority services. I don't think, to be honest, we need any more powers beyond what's currently being discussed. The key for us is flexibility and the ability to direct resource locally to meet local priorities at a local level in terms of the overall resource that we currently control, while we take forward reform to areas like, you know, council tax and consider the implications of new powers such as the infrastructure levy. We're not sitting here saying we've got all these proposals around new powers that we need. We think we've got, you know, a huge array of legislative power at the moment to act on behalf of our communities. But that key issue for us is about flexibility, reducing direction, reducing ring fencing, and allowing local priorities to be funded.
Thanks, Malcolm.
And links very much to public service reform. If there's a different model of delivering local services and being accountable for them, then I think one can look to other jurisdictions, not least Estonia, some of the Scandinavian countries, other models where there is a much more harmony of local and national taxation. That brings in options like local income tax, which have been looked at in the past. So I think it has to be a discussion that looks not just at fiscal framework, but also how we are going to sustain and deliver local services in a way that also allows for local democracy and community empowerment. So it's part of that debate, I think.
Yourself, Malcolm, apologies, might have been David who a few moments ago mentioned more flexibility around fees and charges. I think, I can't remember whose submission it is, certainly the cause of submission around building warrant fees and planning fees. They've been discussed for some time. Are there any other areas that you think it would be beneficial for local authorities to have more flexibility around fees and charges? I think one example that's been brought up previously is parking fines. They're set nationally. Some councils have made the argument that they'd rather set the rates themselves. Are there any examples that you've got of a fee, a charge, a fine, etc., that is currently set nationally, but you have to administer it and you'd rather have greater flexibility?
No particular examples, but I think the principle has to be there should be local determination of local charges like that and accountability for them.
Jimmy, anything you want to add at this point?
I think as David and Malcolm have said, it's about having the effective application of those fiscal levers that councils can use. So it is about the council tax, it is about local discretion, it is about fees and charges, it is about teachers' numbers, and it's removing those fiscal blockers to enable councils to determine their priorities locally and deliver upon those locally.
This is perhaps a question for Councillor Hagman in the first instance, but others may have views on it. At the publication of the budget last year, the Finance Secretary confirmed that she would engage in discussions with local government around exploring the potential for a power of general competence. Have those discussions moved on at all in the period since? Have you been engaged specifically on that?
Specifically on that, but I know that certainly the presidential team, the vice president of COSLA, has been taking forward some of those discussions as well, so I wouldn't be able to comment.
Are there any views across the panel in accepting that that's not your remit within COSLA, councillor? But are there perspectives on what that could look like? Because the idea of a power of general competence, certainly when it was announced, found pretty broad consensus, but when you start discussing it, everybody's got a different idea of what that actually means. And for example, local authorities in England have very limited power to create new revenue-raising levers, so they couldn't create their own visitor levy necessarily. But they do have significant power when it comes to their ability to invest. That's resulted in a couple of local authorities in England making catastrophic investments and going essentially bankrupt, Thanet being the worst example. Do you have any views on what an effective power of general competence would look like? Is it more in the space of being able to create your own revenue-raising powers? You wouldn't need to wait for Parliament to create a visitor levy, for example. Or is it about having some level, with safeguards, a greater ability to invest?
And it's not an area that I've taken forward. Perhaps some of my colleagues might be able to advise a bit more. But I think, you know, it does come down to that principle. And certainly I know that in some of the discussions that have been had, there is levers that we would like to have that are not necessarily in the gift of Scottish Government because they have not been given them from Westminster. So we're working, effectively without being able to get all the opportunities potentially available. So, you know, I know that there has been discussions happening, but I don't have the detail, unfortunately.
Thanks. Jamie, were you looking to come in on that?
Yes, thanks, Chair. I think it's something that the SIPFA Directors of Finance are discussing with colleagues at the Scottish Government and civil servants to understand the power of general competence and what that can effectively mean and what benefits can accrue from that in terms of councils being able to do what they can reasonably do. And I think there's general recourse to legislation in areas of taxation, but perhaps not levies. And I think there's other burdens on Section 95 officers in terms of the Prudential Code, and we've spoken about that previously, that we have to act with kind of with prudence, sustainability, to ensure that any investments that are undertaken don't have disproportionate risk. And I think that some of those conversations about risky investments have been kind of discussed with civil servants already. And I don't think that would be something that directors of finance would be looking to do. And it certainly wouldn't be something that I think we could easily do or do at all within the Prudential Code.
Thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks. Yeah, a power of general competence was actually agreed in the first Parliament with Wendy Alexander as Minister, so it may not have been implemented, but we certainly agree with this Parliament, as anyone who checks the official report will be able to confirm. John, to be followed by Liz.
Thanks so much, Convener. Jamie Robertson, I just was interested in the figure you quoted there as one of your examples. This is an aside before I get into my main questions, but 420,000, I think you said, for a house, building a house in Eastern Bartonshire. Now, you could have my flat for 100,000, which admittedly is not in Eastern Bartonshire, so that wouldn't do you a lot of good. But I just wonder, does that raise the question, are local councils a bit too keen on doing everything gold-plated, absolutely perfect? And wouldn't it be better to use that money? You could buy four flats, they wouldn't be perfect, but buy them off the shelf, but you'd get four families off the streets, because we do have a housing emergency.
So we do that. We have a range in terms of a housing programme. We have a range of options to bring houses into effective use for affordable housing, and whether that's open market purchases, which happens very, very frequently, we have a specific budget for that. But obviously, you know, the costs of retrofitting these, you know, off-the-shelf, off-market kind of purchases for net zero or whatever updated kind of silver building standards is obviously quite significant as well. So we do have a blended approach to the development of our kind of housing estate, and that sits within overall affordability within the housing capital programme, which is significantly tested in terms of how we meet these aspirations going forward and the costs that would have to fall due on the rent payers. So that specific site is
is a challenging site to develop. It's between a canal and an Antonine Wall, and you know, so there are specific reasons why that is the case, but it was brought as an example of, you know, these are the pressures that are facing with reduced recourse to packages of land to develop houses. You know, these are the challenges that are facing councils and ergo are kind of our rent payers as well.
Okay, thanks, that's helpful. When it comes to priorities, probably I'm aiming at you, Councillor Hagman, unless the others want to come in as well. Clearly, we've all got a fixed amount of money, and the question is how we spend it. And I was on the Social Security Committee, so that is the area, and it's been pointed out in submissions that something like £900 million was increased in the budget this year for the Social Security side, which includes the Scottish Child Payment and, I think, a slightly more generous adult disability payment, etc. Has that been a good priority? Is that a good priority going forward, or could we be using the money better?
So I'm here to represent local government. So I will always say that investment in local government is a good use of funds. I know others have been very keen to make the case that actually the increase in the child payment is having a direct effect on families, on individuals, so therefore it's not for me to make that case. But what I would say is, as a local authority, we're looking at whole family supports, we're looking at different ways to support communities, and you know, there is a very uncomfortable and difficult choice and discussion to be had around that universality of funds, and should we be trying to do everything for everybody? And nobody really wants to be in that position. Nobody wants to be the person to say, actually, we're going to have to take away something that you've had in the past. But the fiscal situation that we're looking at means that we have to face those really, really challenging discussions. So while we absolutely value our teachers, and I hate to come back to this point, but you know, we do value our teachers. They do an incredible job. I would not want to be standing up in front of a classroom delivering the education curriculum myself. I've got a huge admiration for our teachers. But in order to support all our young people, all our learners, all the you know, the poverty-related attainment gap, because we've agreed that that's what we're focusing on, we need those learning assistants, we need the breakfast clubs, we need the after-school clubs, we need our libraries in order to offer a safe haven for our young people that, if they've got that. So, yeah, it's a really challenging one, so, okay. Yeah.
I mean, could I maybe ask the others from a kind of technical point of view, because you've brought it up about the, you know, is the Scottish Child Payment or any of the other benefits, is that taking any pressure off local authority finances because families are a little bit better off and therefore they don't need to come to you with their needs? I don't know, if, or is it too early, do you think, to say that, Mr. Robertson?
Answer that in reference to the Scottish Welfare Fund. I think it's during COVID and then the cost of living crisis, we've seen a significant increase in demand. And I think those it's borne out by the local government benchmarking framework. So it's community care grants and crisis payments. And local authorities are overspending their allocation and topping up their allocation to ensure that there's sufficient funds within those people who are facing crisis and are really at the sharp end of the cost of living crisis. So what we can see is an increase in demand and a sustained increase in demand in hardship funds. And a lot of councils are moving to severe most compelling. They're moving through the priority criteria to only award on the most severe cases. And that's one of the ways that local authorities can manage their budgets by targeting funding to the most critical areas of need, and we are seeing that. So actually we're seeing significant demands sustained and continued.
Okay, thanks. Capital spending then, priorities. I mean, housing's already been mentioned, and personally I think housing should be a priority. Is the government spending too much on roads, and particularly on the A9?
I can come in and answer this. I think the evidence that we've put in into the committee here shows that, you know, we aren't spending as much on our roads and infrastructures that we would like to. Obviously, the A9 is not under local authorities, so I wouldn't comment on that. I would maybe, you know, take the opportunity to remind everybody that we've got the A75, which is a Euro route right through my own Dumfries and Galloway, but that's not what we're here to talk about. I think, again, it's how we approach our budgets going forward. Are we person-centred? Are we looking at the whole person? And, you know, there is a reality that, yes, we do need to invest in our roads, we need to invest in our infrastructure, but should that be a priority over people, over our young people? They're really difficult choices to be made. And, you know, again, these are questions that maybe come up in Scottish Parliament, and it's very easy to point the finger and say local government should be doing this and local government should be doing that, but we all have to have that collective joint responsibility to our citizens, to our communities, as to what the expectations should be going forward.
Okay, thanks so much. I mean, you can come back on any of these questions if you want, but I was going to ask you specifically, Mr Burr, on a completely different note, about this, the idea of a single island authority. And would that be something that would save money, or would it just make things a bit more efficient?
I think it's not about saving money, but I think it would, actually. I think if you look at any merger of services, of service delivery, of administration, there is always a small saving, usually about between 3-5%, but that's not the... And certainly we need that money to be ploughed back into frontline services. There's no question of that. That's not primarily what it's about, though. It's a very outcome-focused approach, and it has to be around improving lives and maintaining and improving good outcomes. That's the focus of it. And also community empowerment. I mean, my area, as you know, runs from, if you put it on the map of Scotland, it would run from Glasgow to Aberdeen. It is a long way from Barra to Stornoway. There is a wish to... The wish of all our communities, and we have tested this just recently again, people are saying, why don't you just get on with this? Why don't you just merge the council, the health board, the housing partnership? We know that's not easy. That work, I should say, has increased in pace in recent months, and that's very welcome.
If you took something like IT, I mean, the local, you would still have to relate to the national IT services in the NHS and in COSLA and things, so you wouldn't really save in that area, would you?
I think there are probably management costs at the higher level you would save. I mean, you wouldn't... I always ask, you know, I'll pick on directors of finance because that's what we're talking about. You know, we have chief finance officers in NHS Western Isles, in the Corla, in Hebridean Housing Partnership, in other areas. You know, I think in time that there would be some efficiency savings from that, but that's not the primary motivation. But it has become an increasingly strong motivation because, as I've said before, other options are not really available to islands councils, such as outsourcing, such as the community provides a huge amount of support and services in the Western Isles. I think it's got one of the highest rates of volunteering anywhere. You just can't ask communities to take on more and more, particularly if it's got a statutory flavour to it. So this is our answer. It's not about costs, but we'd certainly... I have no doubt it would free up some funding.
OK, that's great, thanks. And finally, Mr Robertson, I mean, you may want to comment on anything that's been said already, but I particularly picked up in the Borders submission the problem with bid funding, and I just wondered if you could explain what the problem is with bid funding and what you think would be a better way of doing it instead of having to bid for funds.
So in terms of not having to bid for funds, we would prefer resources went through the settlement and distribution and allocation processes so that can be done in line with agreed protocol and engagement with Scottish Government through COSLA and the settlement and distribution group. I mean, the fundamental problem with bidding is the time and resource that these things take without any certainty of outcome, and we just feel it potentially pits one area against another, and ultimately we feel given the pressure on resources, is a bit of a waste of time when we can just agree the outcome we're trying to achieve and push things through an established settlement and distribution process where resources ultimately to be allocated.
Okay, right. Thanks, Convener.
You want to come in there, sorry.
Thank you, Chair. Just in terms of the overall, you asked a question about capital and the sufficiency of capital. I think it's worth kind of highlighting in the submission that Scottish local authorities have about £55 billion worth of assets. And if you were to... The deterioration on those assets, which we can estimate, you know, by proxy through, you know, how we depreciate our assets... Say if we depreciated them over 50 years, which is a very extreme example, the deterioration in our capital assets would be about £1.1 million a year. The funding that we receive for capital is £800 million a year, and that doesn't take into account all the additional capital that we need to invest in terms of our schools, estate, or whatever it might be.
£1.1 billion, was it?
Yeah, so the sort of the write down of the assets every year is about £1.1 billion, and that's a very extreme example. We have to ask specifically if we were going to depreciate over 50 years. So the capital grant that's given is less than the depreciation on the asset base. So effectively, what we're seeing is a deterioration in the overall asset base. And I think that's something that that we're really cognizant of. And that doesn't even include the roads, because the roads aren't included on our balance sheet. So by the time you add that into the mix, you can see that the deterioration in capital assets in councils is exceptionally challenging unless there's recourse to funding, which has a revenue implication.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. List to be followed by Jamie.
Councillor Hagman, can I ask you, how easy is it for your officers to identify within local government the areas where there is the greatest success in making efficiency savings so that, you know, the services are improving, as well as making some tough choices? Is that an easy thing to do within local government, to identify where there's the greatest success in delivering better services?
So we within COSLA, we have our thematic boards, so there's representatives from each of the 32 local authorities that sit on those boards. That's where we can actually have those dialogues across authorities, and therefore ideas can be brought forward within that space. I think we're hugely relying also on our professional advisors, and certainly they will bring forward their recommendations to us, because, you know, we're providing huge amounts of services. I think it was touched upon earlier in terms of our headcount and local authority. Within Scotland's local government, we're providing a huge amount of direct services that aren't necessarily replicated in other parts of the UK. So therefore, we have to be really quite recognising of the range of services. So we absolutely need to work out what works best, and where things are working well, then we can replicate that right across the boards. And I think there's opportunities through the thematic boards' works, and actually through that joint working, that we can take that forward.
So how far down the road do you think that work is? Because if I was a member of the Scottish Government, I would be asking local authority to identify the areas where obviously you're making efficiency savings at the same time as delivering better public services.
So we do have a working group of looking at innovation across the local government, and we're also, you know, very aware that professional advisors are looking at, you know, the councils of the future and how we can take forward that work. Obviously, you know, that's sitting with our chief executives across SOLAS, etc. So, you know, that work is being progressed, and we do have a mechanism within COSLA that can come through the COSLA systems.
To identify where the outcomes of the decisions that you make in local government are better than they have been in the past. Is that work not ongoing? Because I would have thought that was very important when it comes to public sector reform. That, so, you know, if we can see exactly where there has been success, then that's an important discussion, I would have thought, with local government and central government.
So local government benchmarking captures a lot of that data of what is working and where we are, and that's done on a national basis, bringing in all 32 local authorities. So that's a very clear indicator of data that you can say this is working particularly well, and all local councils have access to that data. So I think that is a key indicator that we need to be looking at.
So are these discussions part of the work that you're doing right now with the central government to ensure that, you know, we can identify where we can perhaps make savings but without causing any detrimental damage to services? Because that, I would have thought, is a critical question to answer.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. So I'm obviously the spokesperson for resources, but we have a spokesperson looking at the economy and the environment, and I know Councillor McGregor regularly has contact with ministers taking forward exactly these comments. Councillor Buchanan within education, Councillor Maureen Chalmers across our communities, and we've got Councillor Paul Kelly who's looking at health, etc. So each of the spokespeople are working within their portfolios, taking and highlighting the opportunities where we want to expand and what is working well. And that's the power, I suppose, of having various spokespeople with different remits, because we're all able to go into our area of specialist knowledge and actually take that forward.
Yeah, I understand that, and that's a fair point to make, but do we have good collaboration between the 32 local authorities whereby those that are being successful with particular services, is that being fed back into yourselves so that you can flag up the areas where, as I say, there's a bit more success?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we have professionals that advise all the time, and each of those professionals are working within their, you know, it sounds very much that we're working in silo, and I guess each professional group are, but we do have that opportunity to come together. But my colleagues here can probably give you some worked examples of exactly how they are, especially across directors of finance as well.
Mr. Robertson.
Thank you, Chair. As Councillor Hagman has made reference to, obviously there's the local government benchmarking framework, which is a key piece of work that's undertaken by all 32 councils, and I have the pleasure of supporting the board as part of that work. I think what we have seen is that satisfaction indicators have generally been quite high, and I think this year was the first time that satisfaction has maybe tailed off slightly. The LGBF obviously has a number of different indicators, and we work with all councils to ensure that there's betterment within those indicators. There is a duty of best value that specifies continual improvement within local government in the 73 Act, and that's obviously something that's looked at, audited by Audit Scotland, and the reports go to the Accounts Commission on an individual council-by-council basis. But I suppose by way of a specific example, the LGBF board are looking at pilot studies of individual areas where there's potential outliers in performance, and there's a peer-led collaborative process that would go in and assist each local authority to maybe look at the learning from other areas and see if there's tangible improvements that can be made. I think the most recent one was time taken to process claims. So obviously, in order to, you know, ensure people get their Scottish Welfare Fund payments, the time taken for those application forms to go through the system is absolutely key. And there was a collaborative piece of work that was done at Falkirk Council to understand what happened within their structures that meant that the times were longer than other councils. And I think that's had real positive impact. So that's the sort of work that's happening on a peer collaborative process that's coming through the LGBF board is reported by the Accounts Commission as part of the best value regime, and that's the sort of thing that kind of feeds through to COSLA. So hopefully that gives you a bit of an example.
Yeah, no, that's helpful, Mr. Robertson. I'm interested if there are areas within local government where we are really making good progress. I think it's important to know what they are, because obviously that's a lead as to where else we might make some changes that benefit the revenue, but also are able to improve the outcomes at the end of the day. And I think that's a critical part of sort of the scrutiny of the budget, because we want to know if the money's being spent somewhere, is it being spent well, and is it giving us the right returns? Thank you.
You, Jamie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning. I'm going to come first to Jamie Robertson, if that's all right, because you talked about empowering local councils. I think it was kind of touched on by everybody, but meant it at the beginning. I met recently with organisations, individuals within the tourism and hospitality sector in Fort William, and it's, you'll appreciate, a large part of my casework over the last few months and years, regards to the visitor levy. And one of the concerns, one of many concerns that they raised over that was how it impacts not only on them, their businesses, but also on other businesses such as restaurants, cabs. It's taking, has a wider impact than perhaps just those visiting an area. And so I suppose the question I kind of wanted to ask is, in empowering local communities, are we really, all we're doing is actually just shifting that tax burden onto local communities, local people, local businesses? Do you see that as a pattern? And, you know, what kind of impact is that likely to have on those local economies? Because we could see a situation that this benefits the national government, because they can refocus money on their priorities, whatever it happens to be. Local authorities can obviously fill these large gaps in income, but it's actually those local communities and economies that are going to suffer because of it.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, I read through the previous submissions and I noted that there was a significant amount of concern, and I suppose there has to be due cognizance to the unintended consequences of increasing levies, and this would be something that councils should consider in the application of local levies, to ensure that the income coming in is reinvested and it grows the overall economy. And I suppose we were, the directors of finance were lucky to have a presentation on the tax strategy that is forthcoming. I think that's going to be published at the same time as the budget, and consulting with the directors of finance and getting a sense of what those unintended consequences might be, whether it's council tax or local levy. So it is something that's under active consideration. And I suppose we don't have a local visitor tax or a cruise ship potential within Eastern Bartonshire. However, I would anticipate that as part of any implementation and equalities impact assessments that happen as part of that process, that would be given due consideration in terms of what the impact on local communities and businesses are, and ensuring that any funds that are raised locally can be invested locally, as that has to be the key aim.
There's another concern, and you raise it, is it's around confidence about where that money is going to be invested. Because certainly, if you meet people in the Highland region, which is obviously a huge region, one very large kind of focused area in Inverness, but lots of kind of peripheral communities, and some of those peripheral communities are where probably a lot of the taxes, you know, likely to be raised, or certainly a large amount, and there isn't actually that confidence that money will go back into either those areas, but also into that tourism infrastructure, that it'll just go into revenue. So I was just wondering, you know, where those concerns can be addressed. Councillor Hackett.
I mean, I can come in and speak on this, having led a lot of the work on the visitor levy on behalf of local government. I think it's fair to say that there has been a huge amount of scrutiny of this, and there has been concerns raised, and certainly some of the amendments to the bill that went through Parliament addressed those. I think it's fair to say that local government, and every meeting I have with the Minister, was that we wanted to have these powers and we wanted to be able to enact them straight away. And the consistent message we got back was, in order to bring businesses and allay some of those concerns, is we just need to slow it down. So there's a long lead-in time for the implementation and for the introduction of any visitor levy. I think we've had an expert group feed into that, with both officials from COSLA, but also from the tourism industry, from Visit Scotland, from some of the providers of accommodation, such as Airbnb, etc., have been able to feed into that. And certainly, as part of any implementation, there must be, because it's mandated, a local forum, and that local forum reform will allow businesses to actually feed in direct. So there's been a lot of safeguards being put in, and I would hope that should any local authority wish to take this forward, and Edinburgh is leading on this at this point, then those safeguards have been put in place. And much of this is actually about sharing of information, because there is a concern. But actually, if you start to break down and look at some of the processes that have been brought in as part of the parliamentary scrutiny, those should allay some of those fears.
I suppose, you know, this is obviously one part of this, but the wider principle of, as I say, that moving of tax burden away from the Scottish Government having to provide it, general taxation, into essentially local communities, because it's local people, local businesses. Is that something that concerns you?
Why we have to have that good communication and that local forum. I mean, I think it's fair to say that local government does provide a huge amount of support to our businesses, and we want to grow our economies. Absolutely, that is a priority for local government, because we want to attract investment. And certainly when there are, you know, new powers brought in, we are always mindful of those unintended consequences, and that's where we have a real strength, because we can look across other local authorities, we can look at that best practice, we can look at the local government benchmarking framework and see what is working, etc. So there's a huge power to be able to share information, but actually we also need to recognise that each local authority is very different.
Okay. I'll happily move on to my next point, unless David or Malcolm want to come in on that. If not... Okay, right. Well, Malcolm, you don't get off, because you're the next question I wanted to ask for you, and it's quite it's only a brief one. You talked about being sustained by vacancies, and again, a lot of the casework that I get is about people in my region, Highlands and Islands, that aren't able to access, say, the full care provision that they've been allocated. How much? I mean, I don't know if you're able to do an evaluation of. Not so much those vacancies that you as a council can, you know, slowly slow down recruitment on or keep open, but those things like care costs, which are, you know, have a direct impact. Are you able to put any kind of estimate on how much that is, or how much worse the situation might be, or your budget constraints if you were having to deliver, you were actually delivering what you should be delivering?
If we could fill all posts, I mean, all these posts are budgeted for, I mean, so these are unplanned savings which help us out every year. I wouldn't want it to be implied that these are part of budget strategy. But because there is a certain level of vacancies in social care across the Highlands and Islands, these have come to be the reality. In theory, they must put additional pressure on residential care if we can't provide home care. Or home care to the desired degree. I mean, I'm thankful that in the Western Isles we generally have our own employees. We don't rely on agency employees to a huge extent, and it's still an attractive career. There's just not enough people coming into it. So I think in time, though, it will affect the models of care that we provide. I think there will be more supported accommodation where people can live in their own accommodation, but in a supported environment rather than home care. It is hard to see home care being sustained at its current level in the next 10 to 20 years. Okay. I think that's true across all of rural Scotland.
David, I don't know if you've got anything to add to that.
I think the challenges around delivering care services are acute across the country, and particularly in rural areas, and it's an area that we struggle with, and we unlike Malcolm in the Western Isles, have to rely quite heavily sometimes on agency staff in order to sustain that level of care. Our population pyramid has a very significantly increasing number of older people relative to the rest of the population. That means we've got a lower working age population in order to provide care services, and we are finding it increasingly difficult to recruit to those types of jobs in order to sustain levels of care. It's a major problem for us locally.
You say over the next 5, 10, 15 years that the service you're able to deliver at the moment is sustainable?
I have significant concerns about whether the care services that we're delivering at the moment in our local area are sustainable, given our population demographic the cost of that care and the ever-increasing demand, and we're going to have to look at really innovative ways of delivering care through, you know, technology at home, for example, these types of things in order to sustain the quality and breadth of what we're doing at the moment.
Okay. Thank you.
Wanted a brief supplementary, Ross.
Commuter, just to Jamie, as Easter Martinshire resident, I totally get why typically the visitor levy wouldn't necessarily be on the council's radar. Given the news about the Commonwealth Games and Glasgow, though, is any discussion taking place in Eastern Bartonshire about the potential merits of a temporary levy? Because I imagine every one of our local hotels, B&Bs, everything, they're going to be full for that period.
She'd
be very welcome.
An interesting question, but not to the best of my knowledge. But I understand that, you know, these developments are moving quickly.
Yeah, that news was only 2 weeks ago. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. That's concluded questions from colleagues around the table. Obviously, time is against us. We're over our time, and we haven't been able to touch really on reserves or climate change or really much about economy, productivity or economic growth. But there's just one thing I want to touch on, because it's been raised by, alluded to by Michael and John quite a bit, which is the trade-off between expenditure and welfare as opposed to local authorities. So, paragraph 49, Katie, you've talked about how the benefit budget increased by some £984 million in this financial year, and you've said that the opportunity cost of these decisions needs to be considered. Economic development and employability services, which help to create jobs and support people facing barriers to the labour market, to progress towards into and sustain work and fairly paid jobs, thus reducing dependence on the welfare system and also improving health outcomes. The funding could have been used to create more affordable housing, supporting people out of poverty, reducing homelessness and improving health and education outcomes. So has COSLA actually looked at this and done a cost-benefit analysis comparing that £984 million with how that money could have been spent in local services? Because that's obviously a key point of your submission.
Yeah, so, I mean, again, I think the word could is being referenced within that, and certainly, you know, again, it's about those difficult decisions and options going forward. In terms of specifics, I think it's clear to say, and I mean I can give you a couple of statistics. It's, you know, we've referenced, if the investment had been put into housing, for example, we could have had other benefits. And just to give you just a few examples of that, a Homes for Scotland report suggested that there were roughly 22,000 new homes built in Scotland in 2019, and that created £800 million spend on goods and services and materials. It accumulated £3.4 billion direct, indirect and induced gross value added in there as well. There were £511 million in developer contributions, including £322 million for the affordable housing contribution and £179 million for the infrastructure contribution. So those are exact, you know, had the investment been in there.
Really, this is resource, it's £984 million, it's not really capital guarantee. House construction or anything like that. And of course, the £984 million will, to an extent, have gone towards being spent in local shops. They're not likely to have spent it on, you know, like cars or overseas holidays or whatever. So that's why I'm looking at the opportunity cost, to see if there's specific work being done. I mean, Jamie, you might have some information on that from SEEPFA about, because what we're looking at in terms of making recommendations to the government is where we get the best bang for a buck, in tune with the government's own priorities, one of which is eradicating child poverty. So if we are looking at local government and you're saying that that money could be better spent, you know, on providing local services, you know, to support campaigns against poverty and deliver in all the areas that you've talked about, for example, enabling people back into work, which ultimately is the best way of reducing poverty if you've got a well-paid job, although not everyone in work does have a well-paid job. You know, I'm just looking to see if you've got anything hard and fast on that opportunity cost, because it seems to me that you're advocating that instead of putting additional funding into welfare in the next year, over and above what the current situation is, that money should be redirected to local government.
If I may direct you, and we can certainly send you information on this following the committee for your own reading, At the COSLA conference, we had the Excellence Awards, and there's key examples highlighted of best use of funds going through local authorities, and certainly the overall winners of that was a project in Glasgow supporting mothers whose children had been taken into care and how best to support them for their future outcomes. Now, those are having huge ramifications and positive offering positive outcomes to some of the most vulnerable people in our society. There's examples from Aberdeenshire. My own local authority was awarded an award as well. And certainly we can certainly share those examples of projects that are really making a difference that local government are providing that really affects those vulnerable people within our communities.
Okay, Mr. Roberts. Jamie.
I don't have any empirical kind of evidence to kind of present to the committee. I think, you know, there is that injection of cash within social security that means that it's instant and it affects our communities. I suppose from a local government perspective, putting that funding into the ensuring that policies on early years, you know, teacher numbers, employability work streams, and ensuring that those are fully funded and sustainable will, you know, the counterpart will enable the kind of the delivery of kind of the shared aims across the piece. I recognise that it's a difficult decision, and that's a difficult decision that needs to be made.
It provide a substantial number of jobs in local government itself, would it not?
It would, yes.
Okay. I mean, okay, that's fine, thanks. Incidentally, in terms of local government employment, you talked particularly from Malcolm about reduced numbers from 1900 to 1600, but the figures I have is that since quarter two 2018 to quarter two 2024, the number of local authority workforce in Scotland has actually grown from 242,000 to 262,000. I know about half of them are probably, you know, early learning and childcare, but across Scotland, The trend is actually upwards, not downwards, according to official Scottish Government figures. Okay, I'll just, time is against us, so I'm just going to give our witnesses an opportunity to see if they want to say one final thing to the committee that they feel that we haven't covered, that you think we should incorporate perhaps in our report going forward to the Scottish Government with regard to budget deliberations. So, Katie, you went first, so you have the last word. So of the three gentlemen accompany you, who wants to go first, if you've got anything, if you don't have to, if you don't want to, but if there's anything you feel we should include, please, this is your opportunity. Malcolm, you seem to be keen.
I would just make a plea for the steady implementation of public service reform with a clear timescale and clear milestones along the way, and also the ability to take forward pilot projects in said public service reform, because I think for some of our areas we will really struggle in the immediate future without significant change in that regard.
Okay. David?
I think we didn't really get into it today, Chair, but the issue about local government reserves and the whole, you know, perception that we're squirreling money away for particular purposes. What I would say on reserves is reserves are a snapshot. They're a snapshot at the year end. And they're influenced by the distribution of government grants. They're influenced by things like, you know, Glasgow doing its sale and lease back on its sporting assets. COVID grants coming out at the year end. Service concessions, which have boosted reserve levels significantly on a one-off basis recently, and the reprofiling of loans fund debt. So there are a whole good reasons why local government reserves are spiky. And I think over time what you'll see is those being reduced significantly as pressures on councils grow, but they can only be spent once.
Only about a tenth, uncommitted reserves are only about a tenth of the actual reserves, but uncommitted reserves for local government at 3.4% of local government spend is still more than twice what the Scottish Government's available reserve is, I have to say. Jamie?
I was just going to make the same point as David in terms of just making sure there's absolute clarity in when we're talking about reserves between usable reserves, unusable reserves, earmarked reserves, unallocated reserves. And, you know, I recognise the percentage that you quoted there. However, that percentage only accounts for 12 days running costs for councils and really is a sort of a small backstop, but recognising that across the piece that looks different. But yeah,
it's only a couple of days for the Scottish Government. But Katie?
So just really to close, I think it's important to say that local government leaders across Scotland are absolutely committed to be providing those first-class, frontline essential services to our communities. We are exactly that. We are an essential service. I think it's very important that we continue the dialogue, that we continue to make the case, and certainly COSLA will be producing a lobbying document ahead of the budget announcements. And certainly, you know, in the past, I have met with all finance leads, whether in government or in opposition, and I'm happy to do so again. So if there are any specific questions, then please do get in touch and we will share to the best of our ability our knowledge and expertise with you all. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. That's been very helpful to the committee. We'll hold our last evidence session on managing Scotland's public finances, a strategic approach, at our next meeting when we hear from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Local Government. We'll now take a 5-minute break until 10:55 to allow for a change of our witnesses before moving to our next item. Thank you.
The next item on our agenda is a roundtable discussion on the Scottish Government's proposed national outcomes, which form part of the National Performance Framework. I therefore welcome to the meeting Alan Falls, Senior Policy Officer, Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland, the Alliance, Dr Shoba John, Head Obesity Action Scotland, Carmen Martinez, Policy and Engagement Lead at Scottish Women's Budget Group, Adam Bowie, Business Planning and Performance Manager, Stirling Council, and Sarah Latto, Senior Policy Officer, Volunteer Scotland. I intend to allow up to 90 minutes for this session. As with the previous panel of witnesses, if witnesses want to be brought in the discussion at any point, please indicate to clerks and then they'll then call you. So I'm going to move straight to questions, and the first one is to Shoba, which is it's regarding the Community Empowerment Act. What you've said in your submission is that we are concerned that there is no mention of making any amendments to the Act as it reads currently. And you've gone on to say the current wording of the Act states that public authorities are required to have regard to national outcomes, but you feel this is weak and needs to be strengthened in order that to ensure the legislation is effective. So I'm just wondering if you can expand on that.
Sure. Thank you, first of all, for inviting us. And we're really actually appreciative of the fact that there's a Community Empowerment Act that is there as an implementation tool for the framework. One concern we have with regard to the bill is about the language that's currently there, which is suggesting that local authorities could consider the national outcomes when making decisions. We would rather see the much more stronger, clearer language that suggests that they meet the national outcomes in their local interventions.
Okay, and what do the others feel about that? Any of our witnesses have anything they want to say about that? I mean, one of the things that you've said, for example, Adam, in your submission is that a framework should have structure and that there is no framework and that some, you've said that the circular presentation of national outcomes only suggests that all outcomes are equally important and some arbitrary performance measures have been associated to them.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today. Yes, so what we're doing at Stirling is very much focused on outcomes and building the delivery mechanisms to achieve those outcomes through a thing called outcomes-based accountability. Now, that methodology has been around for a while in different forms, but it allows us to focus on delivering outcomes every day by building in a direct connection to programs and activity that the council officers do and making that connectivity embedded and codified in the council's strategic approach. So, for example, for the doctor's observation about the Community Empowerment Act, we have a specific outcome on communities which really is about the Community Empowerment Act. The council has 10 outcomes and priorities which it needs to achieve within a time frame, and one of those is thriving communities and embedding the Empowerment Act in the council's strategic objectives. In terms of the structure of the NPF, the NPF is fantastic. It's a national framework, a national approach to doing things together. But as I said, I think it lacks a delivery mechanism. It sets out the outcomes for everyone to achieve, but doesn't say how it will do that in brief terms. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, and if we actually look at the changes that are being proposed, Adam, you say that you disagree with care being added. Is this a new outcome? Because you said it's already covered in health, where social care is specifically mentioned. The articulation of the health outcome is better in terms of a specific impact or result we want to achieve.
One of the things I've observed in setting strategic priorities in government is the natural journey to increase the number of priorities, and this is a case in point here. In order to focus attention, really it should be the other way, so to decrease our focus and decrease the number of priorities that any organisation or group does. We already have a focus on health and social care, and that's, I guess, reflected in my comment there.
You disagree, Sarah. You've said that we welcome that the new outcome reflects the need to prioritise social care in Scotland.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it reflects the fact that care has quite often been a bit of a poor relation to health, and it also reflects the fact that Scottish Government are prioritising care as well. I mean, obviously, I'm coming at this from a volunteering perspective, and we're just welcoming the focus, the sort of priority focus on care more broadly as well, recognising that from a volunteering standpoint, you've got there's a lot more sort of resource and support around health than there potentially is around care.
Carmen, to be followed by Alan.
Yeah, I would tend to agree with Sarah as well. We welcome the... Sorry, first of all, thank you for having us here. And the Scottish Women's Budget Group agrees with the new national outcome on care precisely because of those reasons. We usually see more focus on health and less on social care. And the previous witnesses were talking about the challenges of social care in the different parts of Scotland. So I think having this national outcome would definitely help with implementation and to see better outcomes for people in Scotland. And in addition to that, we also know that care and the care economy is very important for women. Women tend to be employed within care. And so this would also help to kind of like achieve a greater equality between women and men in Scotland.
Alan, to be followed by Joan.
Yeah, good morning. Thank you. Just to very briefly add, yeah, we would very strongly support the new national outcome on care. I think we disagree quite strongly with the idea that it was covered sufficiently by health, because as Carmen's touching on and Sarah, care goes far beyond just health and social care. Obviously, social care is very important, but the outcome on care would also include, for example, family care. And again, touching on Carmen's point and points I was making a couple of weeks ago to this committee, you know, that is care that's provided overwhelmingly by women. So having more recognition for care, not just in the limited lens of direct provision of social care, which is very important, but broader sort of how care sort of impacts all aspects of our society, and we think is very important. So we are very, very pleased, as we said in our submission, to see that outcome included in the proposals.
Okay, John.
Come back to both Carmen and Alan on that point. I mean, I think a lot of us are in agreement that care is a good thing to add, but is there a danger we're just getting too many outcomes and we're kind of aiming at too many things, and should we maybe drop something else?
Hey, Carmen?
Oh, sorry. I was also reading the papers for today, and I think that was part of the debate or the conversation 2 weeks ago. If we have less outcomes, is that going to help as well, or are they going to become too blurry or too top-line to achieve what we want to achieve for people? So I don't think there is an issue as such with having 12 national outcomes. Is less than the Sustainable Development Goals, but I think it gives us a pathway to work towards achieving them.
Okay. Anyone else want to add on that one?
You seem to be quite
engaged. I completely agree. I think the fact that there's 17 Sustainable Development Goals and we're looking for greater alignment, I completely agree with Carmen that if you have greater clarity with a more outcomes, then that will ensure that that more issues are given the due attention that they need. And it just kind of goes back to that point around the fact that care was kind of lumped in with health before, but actually care goes much more broadly than just health, and that kind of speaks to that point.
Okay, thanks. Alan, you said in your submission that we don't feel that inequality has been consistently considered across the national outcomes.
Yeah, so I think that's more about sort of threading it appropriately through all the outcomes. So we did say that we're quite pleased to see that, for example, social security has now been given sort of explicit recognition as a route out of poverty. That's obviously very important to addressing inequalities. But I suppose that one of the things, the points that we've sort of often made, not just on this front but in a range of areas, is the sort of not necessarily properly threading sort of human rights through everything we're doing. We talk like quite a big game on human rights in Scotland, but we often view them as this kind of sort of high level, sort of separate thing, rather than the fact that, you know, you have rights to food, you have rights to housing, you have rights to health, and that we're not necessarily embedding that sort of human rights based approach throughout all of these outcomes, and therefore we're not necessarily getting in at the sort of, we're not necessarily tackling the inequalities as best we could. I suppose one of the other, I've lost my train of thought there, I apologise. This is my first day, my first evidence session after 6 days off, so my brain is...
Okay, thank you. Now, Cameron, you've basically talked about how, in terms of equality, the national outcomes need to drive spending and or decision-making.
Yeah, I think it's a recurrent point that we usually make at the Scottish Women's Budget Group, that we need to see better alignment between policy objectives and budgets. And when the budgets become a constraint, we need to see better analysis to see how resources are spent in the best way or how we can avoid increasing inequalities. And I would like to take the opportunity to say that I would agree as well. We would tend to agree with Alan. And part of Engender's response mentioned that they would have liked to see decreasing inequalities as part of the purpose of the national performance framework. And I wanted to take this opportunity to mention that and to say that we would agree with that as well.
Adam, well, people may not necessarily agree with Stirling Council with regard to care. You seem to be on the same page with regard to inequality. You've said there's not enough in the NPF on inequality.
Yeah, I would echo that too. Health inequalities are very much part of what we're trying to understand in Stirling and across the local government landscape. Probably just to add about the care thing, what we're doing in the Stirling Clack Manager Health and Care Partnership is focusing on early intervention and prevention, which absolutely includes carers as a part of that landscape. So I do acknowledge that caring and unpaid carers in this country are very much an unrecognised or under-recognised support mechanism for government.
Okay. Michael.
I think there seems to be a bit of a divergence within the evidence that's been presented to us around the removal of economic growth and productivity from the core purposes around this. And so I just probably start by taking some reflections on that, and then I'll maybe come back in with some other questions on it, if that's okay.
Yeah, and specifically the word innovation, understand, has been removed.
Does anybody
any of our witnesses want to comment on that? Sorry, Carol.
Please, Carol.
So I think we were one of the organisations that said that we were happy with the purpose as it is, the new one, without any mentions to the economy, and this is because of three reasons. First of all, because we know that sometimes economic growth doesn't translate into income distribution, and that can have an impact on inequalities, and or it doesn't help to reduce poverty. Secondly, because we know that economic growth doesn't take into consideration the impact to the environment, so for example, pollution, etc., that can impact on well-being of citizens. And finally, because we also know that at least unpaid work that is usually carried out by women is not taken into consideration in any accounting mechanisms. So removing these things and kind of like focusing on the well-being of citizens, we think could also support the economy. But we don't place the importance on the economy. It's just on the citizens.
Okay. Sarah, to be followed by Alan.
I would very much agree with Carmen. I think we were in favour of the new purpose as well. So Volunteer Scotland, we're a member of the Wellbeing Economy Alliance in Scotland, and strongly believe that wellbeing should be that kind of, it should be the sort of the totem pole that we hang all of policy around. One thing that we did suggest that could be a useful amendment to the purpose is to really focus in on collective responsibility, and it goes back to that point around the purpose of the National Performance Framework. And we think that it'd be useful within the purpose to really recognise that this is about everybody having a kind of collective shared vision about the future of Scotland.
Alan?
Yeah, so just to add, you know, we obviously supported the change in focus as well, and I think that's actually, again, touches on something we were saying in our response around pre-budget scrutiny the other week, which is that sense of moving away from a sort of a narrow focus on economy and economic growth, which often feels like it's very much for its own sake rather than for a purpose. And I suppose this is where we might get onto this a bit later. It's almost like there's an interesting mismatch, because effectively we were, to be quite honest, sort of complaining that sort of focus appears to have been a bit lost with the sort of change in First Minister, and it's moved away from previously having a cabinet Cabinet Secretary who included the wellbeing economy in their portfolio back to just a sort of more traditional view of the economy. And yet in this case, we're sort of praising the Scottish Government for going, hey, we're actually, you know, making a sort of wellbeing, a wellbeing economy focus here. And I suppose that kind of emphasises that there's a disconnect. You know, why is the government in one area moving away from the wellbeing economy sort of framing, having moved further in that direction? And why is it then moving further towards that in a different area? Like, you know, if we're sort of serious about either doing a sort of approach that is focused on more sort of more traditional economic growth, then surely we should do that in every area, and that would include the National Performance Framework sort of purpose. Or if we're serious about a wellbeing economy, we do that in every area, and we do that not just in the MPF's framing, but also the Scottish Government does that in its own sort of government framing and the First Minister's priorities. So there's almost like this disconnect where we're going in different directions in different parts of government, which is slightly confusing.
I'm going to let Michael in a second, but why would any government want economic growth for its own sake? Is it not to generate wealth in order to invest, in order to spend on services?
I mean, certainly, I think that is what people would generally present economic growth as being for. Absolutely, I think that would be people's perception. However, it doesn't necessarily feel like that on the ground, that that's the impact of economic growth. Often that growth is distributed very unevenly. You think about the fact that we have had over the past, you know, over the past 15 years, my entire adult life, we haven't really had much in the way of economic growth that's been felt by ordinary people on the ground. And yet, within our society, both within Scotland, the wider UK, but the wider world, the wealthiest have gotten even wealthier over that time. So often the sort of reason we're sort of resistant on just like talking about economic growth in and of itself is it often feels that growth gets concentrated on those who already have the most rather than those who have the least.
Distribution aren't necessarily the same thing. Michael?
Yeah. I think Alan begins to touch on some of the points I wanted to explore, which was the divergence between, we're told, one of the government's, the First Minister's key priorities is economic growth. Yet we've got this document in front of us that takes that out at the same time. And I wondered whether it talked to some of the other issues that have been raised in the evidence about, in your own evidence, Alan, from the Alliance, that there's this implementation gap between policy objectives and reality. And if you've got government pulling in one direction and then the rhetoric going in another, I suppose it's making me try, what is the purpose of this? Because I think what you're describing, Adam, is almost like an organisational discipline for the bureaucracy to try and drive towards a purpose. But if we're seeing a mismatch between those two forms of language, is that not a core problem? And should there not be coherence across these different areas?
Well, before you come in, Alan, Shoba's been waiting to come in for a while, so we'll let Shoba in and then I'll let you back.
We wanted to look at that question from the point of view of the wellbeing economy outcome. While it mentions wellbeing several times, there is no backing of it in the indicators. And we actually have, Scottish Government has developed the wellbeing monitor, which has very good measures for instance, preventable health, poverty, inequality, which we feel needs to be incorporated into the national performance framework that we are looking at. We also have a concern particularly about the framing of the outcome itself, the wellbeing outcome, where now there's an addition of industry and business spelt out, and that we feel you know, several of the businesses and the business interest could be contributing to ill health and therefore works against the principle of well-being of the community and the country as a whole.
Okay, Alan?
Yeah, just on some of the points Michael was making, I think this comes back to something that witnesses were saying a couple of weeks ago on this topic, which is they were highlighting the specific fact that the programme for government didn't include any reference to the National Performance Framework. There's absolutely no mention of that or the national outcomes. Within that framework, and obviously we've had a change of First Minister, a change of government, and it's almost like, well, we had a different set of, I think the previous First Minister had three missions, there's now four priorities. The loss of the National Performance Framework and the programme for government, but the fact that it's usually included in the budget, there's that kind of suggestion that this is supposed to be sort of an overall guiding framework, but if it's not being followed by every part of government, starting from the First Minister and setting the programme for government down, it then becomes, you know, there is that then problem of, well, is this meaningfully informing the decisions that government are taking? I suppose to go back to Shoba's very early point about, for example, if the Community Empowerment Act is saying, oh, you should think about the National Performance Framework, but not that you should actually, you know, design services and you should work on the basis of, you know, actively, like you have a duty to follow the National Performance Framework, it does feel quite weak. And I suppose I think that was one of the points we made in terms of the relation to the implementation gap, which is, and this isn't just on this front, we know, I think the committee's probably probably heard this term so many times, it's sick of it by this point, but there are so many sort of very good policies in Scotland that aren't necessarily given the teeth or the resourcing to actually sort of bed in and make change on the ground. So we often find ourselves going, this is a really great policy, and then you're like, but where is it in government's actual day-to-day action?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's something that comes through quite a lot in submissions indeed. John?
Yeah, well, exactly on that point. I mean, it does frustrate me, and I think we've talked about it for a long time, that, you know, many of us do not stand up and mention the National Performance Framework in Chamber very much. I mean, so I suppose specifically for Alan, has he any suggestions? I mean, A, does it matter? If it's underneath everything, do we actually need to talk about it? And B, if we do need to talk about it, how do you think we can get it more up profile?
I think definitely there's a case for if this is the government's framework, then the government should at every opportunity, but then at least within its formal sort of strategy documents, at least make clear, well, we have this framework. How is this strategy, or how is this programme for government? How is this budget? And as I've said, the budget usually does. How are these aligning with that? I don't think that necessarily needs to follow through, that the First Minister needs to stand up in the chamber and go, and under the heading of, you know, this outcome, this is what we're doing. I don't think it needs to be that level, but at least in terms of if it's clearly demonstrated the government is using it, then that's what we'd want to see, because as you're saying, it could underlie it, but if the government's not saying that it is, it might not be underlying it. How do we know they've actually applied it if they're not saying explicitly in the programme for government, this is how this will meet these national outcomes?
John, you come back to that, then I've got a couple of others.
Right, just a supplementary on that. I mean, are you aware, or is anyone aware of, in other countries, because there seems to be a suggestion that maybe in Wales or elsewhere it is more talked about, and why that's happened?
That's not something I could sort of personally speak to at this point.
That's all right.
Okay, Adam to be followed by Sarah.
Yes, thank you. So my job at Stirling Council is to make sure that Council adopts the right performance management arrangements, both for its legislative responsibility, but also its organisational operations. The way I've done this is, in some ways, created a layered approach. The first layer is the strategic layer. Delivering, we have, as I mentioned, 10 council priorities, and we've built that as the first layer that everyone sees and reports to in terms of performance. The second layer then is operational. The third layer is LGBF. What this does is tie in the different layers for everyone in the organisation and helps them understand the resolution, which I think is really important, creates structure, as I've talked about before, but also enforces people to have the continuing conversation for us officers with councillors and members and the public about what we're delivering regularly in all of those three layers.
So what you've suggested is a hierarchical ownership and accountability for each national outcome and a single theory of change delivery model for each national outcome. So I wonder if you can talk to that a wee bit before I let you.
Yes, so as I mentioned, we have 10 priorities, which are outcomes-based, and all of our performance arrangements are performance reporting to committees, to our members, is structured in that way. First, what we're doing in terms of progress towards delivery of those 10 priorities, and then, as I said, the other layers come into effect as well. But that forces everyone to say, how are we going in terms of delivery? It's always on the agenda. In terms of the accountability aspect, each of the 10 priorities are owned by a particular senior responsible officer, and they have to speak to them, to members and the public, about how the delivery of their priority is going there. So there is that accountability, which is really important. Underneath that, each of those priority owners have a delivery team, which includes myself and other service level experts, and they advise on how to help deliver and manage performance going forward, not only report on performance looking backwards, but manage performance going forward. And that's also a key principle that I'm trying to share with all my colleagues. Performance reporting is looking back, performance management is looking forward, and we're trying to manage performance and look at the results that we're getting and make decisions about those results, turning the curve, if you like.
Okay, Sarah.
I think it just goes back again to that the core purpose of the National Performance Framework around, well, we'd made the suggestion around collective responsibility, and I think it's from that what we mean is it's recognising the importance of accountability and also scrutiny. So there's a role for government, but equally a role for elected representatives in terms of referring back to the National Performance Framework and the national outcomes on a fairly regular basis to hold the government to account. And I mean, equally, we were frustrated that the Programme for Government didn't make any reference to the national outcomes, because we... So just as an example, so we are... Volunteer Scotland, we're the National Centre for Volunteering, and we're the lead implementation partner for the Volunteering Action Plan. Now, the Volunteering Action Plan led on from the Volunteering for All Outcomes framework, which was developed in 2019, and that was mapped to the national outcomes. So from that, we then have the Volunteering Action Plan, which is basically driving all of our work as a publicly funded body. And we're now in the process of developing the monitoring and evaluation framework for that. And again, referring back to those outcomes that were developed in 2019 that were mapped to the national outcomes. So I think that, for us, is a kind of an example of how the national outcomes should work. It should be, even though we made that relationship or made that connection back in 2019, it's still leading and informing our implementation of the Volunteering Action Plan. And it goes again, I suppose, to procurement as well, and recognising that when you are procuring organisations like our own in the delivery of public services or in the support of public services, then the national outcomes should be your kind of primary... all sort of public activities should be, again, going back to those national outcomes. And that, for me, should be the purpose. And it goes again to that point that we made around collective responsibility. And I think, so we've been quite involved in the Social Justice and Social Security Committee inquiry into third sector funding, which is ongoing. And I think something that's come up fairly frequently, I mean, obviously there's a lot of frustration around third sector funding, but one thing that's come out really loud and clear throughout the inquiry is that the third sector they do not shy away from accountability. In fact, they are probably one of the most scrutinised parts of public service delivery that you'll find in Scotland, but with less and less resource. So for us, I think the national outcomes would provide some really useful framework for that kind of accountability, but also the scrutiny as well.
Shoba?
So from our perspective, we see the National Performance Framework as very useful in holding the scope to help local authorities in their decision-making, and particularly for the planning departments, if they are looking at proposals, development proposals, for instance, for new junk food outlets. Right now, the local authorities do have levers around factors like contributing to noise levels or contribution to litter, but the authorities do need strong levers, such as, for instance, looking at the obesity levels in the local area, or in terms of the density of current outlets, food and drink outlets in the area, clustering of them, proximity of the proposals to places where children and young people gather. So some of those local levers, the scope to be included in the national outcome, particularly the community's national outcome. It's currently not reflected, and we would strongly call for that. And we see, therefore, the framework is holding the scope to enable local authorities through local levers to implement the plans in a way that's contributing towards well-being.
Okay, thank you. Now, one of the areas that I think is important that you've highlighted, Cameron, is the fact that how outcomes should drive spending and decision making. Mm-hmm. So I just wonder if you can expand on that a wee bit, see what others have to say on that.
So, in the same way, Alan has mentioned how we should see or hear more about the national outcomes when people are debating policy. Budgets underpin some of these policies and are key for the implementation of these policies as well. So having the national outcomes underpinned by strong indicators that also make reference to budgets would be very important to really measure the progress towards achieving the outcomes. And budgets are part of the policy-making process in order to deliver services and to ensure that policies are implemented. The budgets are a key part of this. And so I think we need to get better at not making the case, but maybe reflecting the relationship between those policy objectives and how the budgets are backing up those policy objectives.
OK. Alan, what do you feel about that, about how the NPF should drive spending decisions?
I suppose that, you know, as I said, we kind of hope that there's a more sort of a human rights thread throughout the outcomes, and there is a fair bit of that in terms of the inclusion of things around health and education, equality and human rights and housing. So similar to points that we often make at the Alliance about human rights budgeting and the importance of making sure that those considerations are central to budgetary decisions, I suppose the national outcomes could be one way of embedding that sort of more human rights approach within our budget setting. So making sure that when you are taking decisions, including, for example, in-year spending decisions, we've seen those spending decisions, you should be able to justify those on the basis of the national outcomes. Like you're saying, well, we have made this particular spending decision, we've increased spending in this area, we've cut it in this area, and that is in line with the national outcome for X, Y or Z. So you should be able to use these as sort of your guide rules for why you have done spending. And if you find yourself as a government making a spending decision and you find that, oh, I can't actually find a national outcome that this spend relates to, there's perhaps a question then of, well, is that, should you be doing that? Should you be taking that spending decision if it doesn't relate to one of the core outcomes that you as a government have committed to?
OK. John?
OK, again, thanks to follow on from that. In your evidence, Alan, you talk about the NPF is reliant on the government dedicating sufficient resources to doing so. So are you arguing that there would have to be more resources in order to do that, or do you think the present resources, given that we're quite constrained, could be used better to fit in with the National Performance Framework?
I think there's a mix of both. I think, you know, not to sort of go back over ground and on the sort of the pre-budget scrutiny the other week, we do think there are opportunities in terms of improving and increasing sort of the revenues that are available, particularly for local government. My favourite line: I was only a year old when they brought in the council tax valuations. We're still using those. I'm 34. A significant reform to local government financing could free up a lot more. Increase the amount of resource that local government have and also make that resource more sustainable, more predictable over the longer term, and therefore that could improve the delivery of services. And whilst in the short term that creates a sort of, as I said, hopefully that would result in increased revenues, that stability over the longer term probably improves planning, and therefore, you know, I'm not saying that they would need to increase that level of taxation every single year. And I suppose points that were made by Lewis Ryder-Jones from Oxfam last time, that there are probably still things that we could do over how our income tax system is structured, perhaps less tinkering, as it were, compared to sort of what the UK does. And instead, do we take a more sort of comprehensive review of, well, how do we build a distinctly Scottish system that isn't constrained just by, well, let's add 1 or 2% onto the Scottish level. So I suppose there is a mix that, you know, if we're honest, there are lots of areas, particularly social care, where we do think that there is much more need for more resource, and we do recognise that things are constrained. But if the government has committed to providing these services and it's committed to a human rights basis for provision of services, it is also committed to identifying the resource to do so, and going, well, we don't have enough, isn't good enough. The question then becomes, how do you identify that additional resource? Like, it's incumbent on the government to go, well, if we don't have enough, we have a duty to find that revenue.
Thank you, Sarah. To follow by Carmen.
I absolutely agree with what Alan said. I think it's really important that spend. I mean, otherwise, what's the point? I think it's really important that spending should be aligned with the National Performance Framework. But just to kind of build on that, I think it's also about the sort of the scrutiny of when spending has happened, what has been the return on investment. I think that's incredibly important. And just to go back to the Social Justice and Social Security Committee inquiry into third sector funding, one of the things that's been raised is that there appears to be a bit of a disconnect in terms of spending decisions, particularly in the third sector, and the impact that those bodies are making. So for us, I think it's recognising that when spending decisions are made, when services are procured, it's that feedback loop, and it's then thinking about, well, what has been the impact of that spending, and then where there has been a really positive impact, which you see with quite a lot of third sector organisations, it's about then, well, how do we make sure that service has increased funding or is rolled out, and we learn from that and we roll out in different places. Whereas the reality of what we're seeing at the moment, where the third sector have seen in a lot of instances a sort of 20 to 30% real-time decrease in their funding over the past 10 years, despite the fact that we know the third sector has been lauded, particularly over the pandemic, for having had a considerable social impact and contribution to a lot of the national outcomes. So for us, it's about the spending, but also then that follow-up on, well, has there been that return on investment? And then what's the follow-through if there's not been that return on investment?
OK, Cameron, to follow by Adam.
Yeah, so one concrete example of how we could see the national outcome supporting or driving a spending would be the national outcome on care. So from our perspective, we would hope that this national outcome will drive a spending, and we would see... less news when it comes to March or April, and local authorities pass their budgets, and suddenly we start seeing headlines about like the number of cuts affecting social care services across local authorities. So this would be a mechanism to scrutinise whether or not budgets are working towards supporting the national outcomes, and concretely this one on care.
Okay, thank you. Adam, to follow by Michael.
Thank you. One of the things that occurs to me with spending is we probably actually don't know how much it costs to achieve outcomes at all. This is one of the things we've tried to address in local government, and again, I'll go back to the methodology that we're using in Stirling, is outcomes-based accountability. What outcomes-based accountability allows you to do is draw upon a couple of tools. One is the development of a theory of change model, and a theory or a logic model. And a logic model is a conceptual understanding about what actions we need to do to achieve outcomes. So, as I say, in Stirling we've used this to structure our delivery mechanism so that we understand specifically what actions contribute towards the achievement of our outcomes. Then, the second... maturation, if you like, of that process is to account and cost all those activities so we actually know how much those outcomes cost the council to deliver.
Thank you. Michael?
Yeah, so thinking about this as a decision-making tool, I mean, is it not the case in the absence of economic growth, there's going to be less resources as demand grows? So... If we don't grow the amount of finance available to the public sector through economic growth, we'll have less because climate change, technological change, demographic change, increasing pressure on our public services. So does this not just really become a tool to prioritise cuts? So rather than saying what works, is a question of what doesn't work. And is this an effective tool to determine what doesn't work, would be my question to the panel.
Okay, Shoba.
You know, we've been discussing about spending, and I was just thinking one of the things that we propose is looking at where did the money come from, and you know, looking at the commercial drivers of health risks, for instance, tobacco, alcohol, and unhealthy food. They actually hold within themselves the potential, for instance, a health supplement that then generates revenue to address not only prevention of non-communicable diseases, but also to supply healthy food and other care services, particularly in deprived communities. So in that sense, you know, there is a solution right within the problem. If you're able to, within the devolved powers that we have here in Scotland, to have a health supplement. And therefore, you know, I just want to respond to the other side of spending, in terms of where do the resources come from when we do have that potential available within our means.
Thank you, Alan, to follow by Sarah.
Yeah, just about Just a second, sort of maybe slightly push back on the frame of the question, which seemed to start with, well, if we don't have economic growth, perhaps that's sort of relating to some of the earlier discussion we had about the shift in focus towards well-being economy rather than simple economic growth. Just to emphasise, I don't think anyone here is suggesting, certainly Alliance would never suggest, that we shouldn't have economic growth. And in fact, not to be a bore and quote the well-being economy and fair work outcome, but it does say we have a competitive entrepreneurial economy that is fair, green and growing, with thriving businesses and industry and fair work for everyone. I think that's quite a good sort of balance. I think that encompasses the balance that we would like to see, which is saying that, yes, we should have economic growth. That's really, really important. And that part of that growth is having a green economy. It's having fair work. So it's very much not the case that you were saying that there should be no economic growth and then we're using this to prioritise cuts. And I would certainly suggest that whilst I was talking about, you know, we could use this as a framework for saying, well, if this particular thing isn't within within the outcomes, that could then be used as justification not to do that spending. I would be quite concerned, effectively, if the Scottish Government was to end up using things like this as sort of almost a defence for cuts, and like, because I'd actually find it quite hard to see how it could do so in a sort of meaningful sort of rights-based way. Because, for example, if you've got both education and health and care within these outcomes, those are there's no hierarchy of these outcomes. There's nothing which is put above the others. So I don't know how it could be used for that purpose to sort of guide cuts, because you would be saying, well, no, we need to provide both of these things. And it comes back to what I was sort of, I suppose, my answer to John's question, which then becomes, well, if you're trying to achieve these things and you don't currently have enough resource, what do you do to get the resource? And that could be reforms to revenue, but it could also be, you know, how you approach that fair economic growth.
Sarah?
Alan's kind of stolen my point, but I think my point as well is just that the importance of it's about sustainable economic growth and making sure that when there is economic growth, that it's generating public money that can be spent on public services. That I think is the most important thing. But I do appreciate that, given that we have seen, I think, the First Minister in the Programme for Government called it unprecedented times. So I do appreciate that we have got quite considerable inflation at the moment and that there is a considerable squeeze on the public purse. But I think rather than about using the National Performance Framework or suggesting that it would be used to inform what gets cut, I think it's about prioritisation. And that's where it would be incredibly useful, because it's about making sure that you're prioritising services that are ultimately working towards your national outcomes is the most important thing. And it kind of goes back to, I mean, I know that I've said it before, but when we're talking about third sector finances, like there is very good, strong evidence that the third sector are consistently supporting the delivery of public services and that there is a strong return on investment. And yet we're not seeing necessarily the same investment in the third sector from public sector. And it's how that decision has been made, I suppose, for some in the third sector is a little bit baffling. And it makes us feel a little bit like, well, why are we working so hard to deliver these public, to deliver such great outcomes when we're not getting the return in terms of the investment? But I mean, I think that the reason why we do keep doing it is because we're supporting people who need those services most. So.
If you prioritise towards the national outcomes, and that word prioritisation suggests that there will certainly be other areas where funding would be reduced. Would that be correct in terms of the analysis, in terms of fixed or fairly limited budget?
Well, I mean, that I suppose that is the reality, isn't it, is that decisions have to be made. And we've heard multiple sort of ministers talk about difficult decisions, but it is about prioritising those things that are going to have the largest impact.
OK, John?
Again, exactly on that point. I mean, does the National Performance Framework, I mean, Alan's just said it doesn't help us prioritise cuts because there's no hierarchy, but is the same not true? It doesn't really help us prioritise spending because there's no hierarchy. And if you're choosing, say, as I've already mentioned this morning, between the A9, duelling and building houses, the National Performance Framework doesn't help us because both can fit in somewhere in the National Performance Framework, can't they?
A flaw with the National Performance Framework is that there's not an implementation plan. So we've got the quite high-level national outcomes, which are sort of useful in terms of providing a steer, but the fact that we don't have that implementation plan that's tied to the national outcomes makes it very difficult, I think, to do that prioritisation. And this is, it kind of goes back to the fact that we've got a programme for government, which isn't isn't explicitly aligned to the national outcomes, which makes it quite difficult to see the connection between decisions that have been made by the government for this year and the national outcomes as they stand.
Adam to fall by Alan. Adam to fall by Carmen.
I would agree with Sarah. The implementation plan is key. There's no use in having performance information if you can't act on it or don't act on it. That, as I said, performance is performance reporting, which is looking backwards. What we do need to do is embrace performance management, which looks forwards. Use the data, make new decisions based on that data and what we're seeing. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Carmen, to be followed by Alan.
Thank you. So I wanted to go back to the point of the purpose of the framework, which is achieving well-being for people in Scotland now and in the future. So if we think about that in terms of budget constraints and cuts and all of these things that are not very exciting because the framework should really push us to achieve more. But we could think, what are the risks in terms of well-being? Okay, there are no priorities within the national outcomes, but if we don't achieve well-being or if we go backwards, right, what is the cost to that for our economy? If we get sicker people, how is that going to impact on levels of unpaid care? Or if we get people that are not able to participate in the workforce because of a lack of social infrastructure, how is that going to impact on the labour market, for example, and on the economy? The OECD has been doing quite a lot of work as well about gender equality and closing gender gaps to help closing fiscal gaps. So there is, in the case of Canada, for example, they have improved accessibility and affordability of childcare to bring more women into the labour market, and that supports growth. So again, I suppose we should look at this. It's up to us how we look at this and the perspective we use. But I think increasing well-being or the risk of not increasing well-being could have costs as well that will add to the budget pressures.
Alan.
Yeah, so at this point, I really want to emphasise that the Health and Social Care Alliance does not have a position on dueling the A9, but it has been given as an example. So I'm going to do it as a thought experiment. So you're saying, A9 versus housing, they could both be said to fit the national outcomes and the national performance framework. And then could it be used to prioritise those? If I was, again, doing this purely as a thought experiment, if you're talking about a significant road dueling project, you might query, is that in line with a green and growing economy? You might question whether or not that's in line with the national outcome on the environment and protecting the environment. And you might also question whether or not it's in line with the international one, which recognises that we are connected globally. And so anything that we're doing in this country that might have a climate impact has international impact. So there's kind of almost three outcomes there where you might, and again, thought experiment, not taking a position here, where you might say that actually, for a relative sort of prioritisation of spending, A9 dueling doesn't necessarily meet the outcomes. Whereas if you're talking about housing, where we live in safe, high quality housing, people have communities that are connected. Because sort of you could argue that housing matches more of these and doesn't have any negatives, if that makes sense. So you probably could go in that case, well, if the case of capital spending and we're making the choice, if that was the choice that was on the table, and I'm not saying it is the choice on the table, and the choice was between a road building project or housing, you would do the housing because that's more in line with the national outcomes. And as I said, that's a thought experiment. That's my reading of the outcomes. I'm not taking a position, but just because that was the example given.
Your neutrality is noted, Alan. I want to move on to the UN Sustainability Development Goals. So, for example, in its review document, the Scottish Government reported that they'd heard from stakeholders that alignment with the United Nations goals could be improved. But Carmen, in terms of your own submission, you say that in some respects the proposed national outcomes are less ambitious than the UN Sustainability Development Goals. For example, SDG 1 seeks to achieve no poverty by 2030, as opposed to reduce poverty, which is a national outcome. And you reiterate concerns about a lack of focus on gender equality in the national outcomes.
So we mentioned that there are differences in the national outcomes. Some of them might be due to the specific context in Scotland. So, for example, there is a national outcome on housing, and that might be due to different council areas calling the housing emergency. But yeah, we noted that there is a kind of like, or what it seems a lack of ambition in terms of like that no poverty and or reduced poverty in the case of Scotland, and the semantics in this case are important. It is also true that the Sustainable Development Goals include a goal dedicated to reducing inequalities. So that, going back to the point that Alan made, one on gender equality and one on peace, justice and strong institutions. And these three have been all kind of like amalgamated into the equality and human rights. So that's why we say that they are less ambitious, and we, alongside other women's organisations in Scotland, would have liked to see a dedicated outcome on gender equality that kind of like is to potentially increase policy coherence across the different strategies within the Scottish Government. And also because when we talk about eradicating child poverty, or when we talk about like the care economy, etc., we are talking essentially about women. It's like usually over 80% of women are working in the care industry. It's usually women who tend to work part-time after having children and filling all those gaps. And that has an impact on women's financial equality. So, that would be a point that we would like to make. And finally, that lack of kind of like focus on gender equality, Angela O'Hagan has spoken about it as well, and how she made a point about how we could see a further evaporation of gender in the framing of equalities. So having something specific about gender would have been welcome.
Okay, so this section, I'm happy for people to come in. Any issue about UN Sustainable Development Goals, we've already kicked off there with lack of ambition and gender inequality. Alan.
Yeah, I'd wanted to come in on that point about the sort of no poverty thing as well. So we'd noted the exact same thing in our response, that there was that sort of difference in ambition between the Sustainable Development Goals and the national outcomes, with the SDG being no poverty. I think also, again, coming back to points we were discussing earlier about sort of maybe a slight misalignment between different things at sort of across the government. Obviously, one of the First Minister's four priorities is eradicate child poverty, and that obviously is a much more ambitious statement than simply reduce child poverty. And certainly, you know, we would, I think everyone in this room, regardless of party or organisation, would obviously want it to get, you know, down to no poverty. But I suppose that a point that we also made in our response, though, is that there might be a recognition of sort of being realistic in their ambitions. And I suppose that one of the things I've perhaps been thinking about more recently is that we can often talk about sort of the powers of this parliament and the government as being almost sort of unlimited, which obviously is not quite the case. So not to open that kind of worms, but obviously it's a simple fact of devolution, that devolution is by its nature limited, and people will have different views on whether or not that limitation is a good or a bad thing, but it is limited. And I think there's a little bit of it perhaps risks undermining trust in the parliament and the government and in devolution itself if we were to set out and say, well, this parliament can eradicate poverty, it can get poverty down to zero. It can't, because so many of the levers to achieve that, particularly around social security, and this is the point we explicitly made in response, so many of those levers are held at UK government level, and it's about the two governments working together to achieve those things. And by definition, that the Scottish government's national performance framework can't bind the UK government. So there is a thing where, yes, we would like to see more ambition, but is sometimes maybe a little bit less ambition about recognising the genuine limitations of devolution, rather than over-promising and then just perpetuating that implementation gap we've sort of highlighted at various other points.
Okay, no one suggested coming in, so I'm going to volunteer, Sarah, at this point, because you've talked about volunteering is also recognised by the UN as a key driver in global delivery of the Sustainable Development Goals.
Absolutely. So the UN recognised the important role that volunteers play in the delivery of services, and I think that that's reflected in the fact that we think that there should be a specific indicator, a standalone indicator, which looks at volunteer participation, particularly given the challenges that we've seen around volunteer participation in the past 4 or 5 years. Regarding the relationship between the Sustainable Development Goals, I would agree with Carmen and Alan. I think that it's there probably could be, it could be more ambitious, but equally I think it's important that we have to recognise that this is Scotland's national outcome, Scotland's national performance framework, and it's important that it reflects specific issues within Scotland. So it's been identified that social care is a particular challenge in Scotland and you know the wider UK as well. But also I know so in my previous role I worked for Shelter, so I'm also acutely aware of the challenges around housing as well. So this isn't necessarily from Volunteer Scotland perspective, but personally I recognise the importance of housing being in there as well. But I think that to kind of concentrate on the outcomes and whether or not they align with the Sustainable Development Goals, it is important, but I think actually what's more important is the indicators that sit below that. And I think I'm quite disappointed that, well, for a start, within the consultation, there wasn't any specific questions about indicators. We took the opportunity within our response to talk specifically about indicators, but just recognising that there's not a commitment to consult more widely again around specific indicators, which I think could be a real barrier and a challenge, and potentially exclude a lot of organisations and a lot of important stakeholders being able to suggest what would be a good measure of the national performance framework.
You just touched on consultation. You weren't very enamoured with the consultation, were you, Adam?
Yes, I think the conversation about indicators is really interesting because most people have a view about what should be measured. And I come from a science background and what should be measured depends on what you're doing, I suppose. So that's an interesting question, side question. The consultation, yes, I think if this is going to be a collective, a thing for the whole country, then you need to involve the whole country in different ways too, in ways that meets everyone's needs, not just perhaps a survey, perhaps lots of face-to-face, lots of community involvement, lots of engagement with different sectors. Really important to get everyone involved, and I don't see that there's been that investment, I guess, in that area. Probably.
Thank you. Shoba?
We wanted to weigh in on the Sustainable Development Goals, and particularly we find that there is overall alignment between the national outcomes and these SDGs, but one area that where we could do better in the national outcomes is pertaining to SDG 17, which is popularly referred to as a partnership goal, and it requires governments to also address conflict of interest. And, you know, just in the discussions that we had here about economic growth versus well-being, we saw that there are tensions that arise when we try to implement national outcomes, and that's particularly accentuated at the local level when local authorities have to take decisions and with multiple stakeholders with diverse viewpoints and interests. So that's something that national outcomes need to reflect in terms of recognizing the conflict of interest that could arise in the implementation and providing guidance and tools for local authorities to address it in their decision making.
Michael?
Yeah, I think there is a real tension between this, the powers, the capability and the kind of long-term stretch targets around eradicating poverty, which we have universal agreement about. But I do worry that around some of these statements that we do undermine the credibility of institutions and actually lose the trust of the public. Would a better goal not be to, well, kids in Scotland are a year behind in mathematics education than they are in the rest of the UK. Could we not say we should close that gap? Is that not a more practical thing to say that we should do as a set of institutions and a group of people? Would that not then help us achieve these other ends around eradicating poverty? And would it not be more intelligible to the public to actually be clearer about actually here's something that's actually doable, clearly within the bounds of the responsibilities of the Parliament, fully devolved education for the last 25 years? There's no good reason why we should be a year behind the rest of the UK in maths education, is there?
Sarah, before by Alan.
I think it's an interesting point, and actually, just going to what Adam was talking about theories of change. You've got these very high level outcomes, and I think there's not an organisation in the third sector who's not familiar with outcomes based reporting and outcomes based delivery. But I think if you look at it from a sort of theory of change perspective, what you tend to have is you'll have your short, medium, and long term outcomes. So with the national outcomes, they are very clearly your long-term outcomes. But what you're suggesting, Michael, would be a particularly useful potentially as a medium-term or short-term outcome. But then it goes back to that point about the implementation plan. So if we're looking at it's an implementation plan with clearer, sort of more bite-sized sort of milestones to work towards is what makes this more sort of tangible and something that's much easier for organisations like ourselves and individuals like myself as a policy officer to be able to interact with. Because I agree that high-level outcomes can feel quite distant and difficult to achieve, but it's only once you start breaking it down into more tangible ones that you actually find meaning.
I mean, I think, to be fair, the education learning proposed new outcome is a bit woolly. It says we are well educated, have access to high quality learning through our lives, and are able to contribute to society. It's a bit difficult to measure, to be fair. Alan, to follow by Adam.
I suppose that phrase is a bit difficult to measure. It's quite a useful one because, as Sarah was saying earlier, we don't yet have the indicators that are going to be used to measure what these are. Obviously, the indicators of the current set of goals. I suppose just in Michael's specific point, I think it just builds on what Sarah was saying, which is that that's a very good example of a specific short-term goal that we really should be achieving. We should have already achieved. Obviously, it's not great to be in that position, but it's not necessarily something that's obviously that this is a longer-term framework for aspirations as a society and as a society, we probably should aspire more to just closing that gap, and we should have broader aspirations on education than just that one thing, which would itself be an important specific policy or specific target to meet in the short term whilst trying to achieve these overarching goals, I suppose is the way I would see that.
Adam?
Thank you. Yeah. No doubt we need aspiration, and that brings people along with us, but we need to be realistic, and I think that's what we've been talking about. The different layers back from national outcomes. There needs to be something in between that fills that gap, that allows all the stakeholders to do the stuff that allows us to achieve our aspirations. To have quick wins, to show progress, that's really important. And that's the pragmatism and, I guess, the reality of the doing, I suppose. Yeah.
Alan, human rights is very important to the Alliance. I just wonder if you can expand on that and your view of the proposed new national outcome for equality and human rights.
Yeah, so just, I suppose, briefly on that, is that we are very, very pleased to see that there is that focus on equality and human rights and recognising that those two things very much go hand in hand. I suppose one of the points that we've made, and I kind of just made it there as well, is that we're a little bit stunted in what we can say on the sort of the exact functioning or proposed functioning or of that outcome by the fact we don't yet know what the indicators are going to be. And I suppose under the current framework, we've been a little bit dubious about the indicators that exist under the human rights one. It was a bit kind of, I think the sort of the phrasing we've used is more sort of focused on kind of like civil and political rights and not on people's social, economic and cultural rights. And that wasn't really there was a bit of a mismatch there. There wasn't anything about, for example, discrimination, how people one of the indicators could be, are people experiencing discrimination in their lives? Because that's obviously quite important to equality. So going forward, when we're sort of thinking about the next stage and the government's considering what indicators, we would want to see a bit more teeth to what kind of things they're measuring to get a sense of what sort of we mean by human rights. And I suppose, as I said, that runs throughout the entire framework. So to go to a point that Adam had made earlier about the difficulty of kind of, it's often difficult to identify how much spend you might need for something. The addition of a national outcome on care, one of the indicators under that could be, or like part of one of the indicators could be, to identify unmet need. We know there's a huge amount of unmet need in social care at the moment. So, and we know that provision of good quality social care helps people to realise human rights, equal participation in society and the right to independent living for disabled people in particular. So if there was an indicator there that allowed us to better identify what the unmet need is, that then gets us more data for what kind of resource and where we need to put it to deliver the national outcome in care, that then delivers on people's human rights. So there are opportunities there, but as I said, at the moment, because we're just on the outcomes and we haven't yet got the indicators for those outcomes, there's a bit of a limitation on how good we can say it, how good or bad we can say those human rights indicators will be.
Thank you. Sarah, you were nodding away there.
Yeah, I was just thinking, I think the indicators point is a really, really important one. And it's something that, so currently with under the community's outcome, there is a composite indicator for, called social capital, which includes several different measures, including volunteer participation. But it's quite opaque, it's not particularly clear. So basically you've got these four different measures that are put into, some calculator somewhere, and it spits out this quite meaningless number. And actually it makes it very difficult to fully understand the challenge that we're facing in terms of community wellbeing. And one of the challenges that we're seeing as well is that so within the community outcome, you've got community asset transfers, or the number of community asset transfers, as an outcome of good sort of community wellbeing. But what we're finding when we're speaking with volunteers on the ground is that there's a huge amount of strain being felt by a lot of volunteers. And actually, we think that that could be not just community asset transfers, but the increased pressure being placed on volunteers is one of the reasons why volunteer participation is in decline. And quite a number of the government's priorities are reliant on the efforts of volunteers on the ground around community empowerment, local democracy and all those types of things. So the point I'm making with that is that indicators are really important about providing that holistic picture. And without volunteer participation being a separate indicator, you're not getting the full picture there about because community asset transfers numbers, great, you're getting increased. But if you're not getting a similar increase in the number of volunteers, then that there is a tension there that's going to snap at some point. And it kind of goes to one point around the point I made earlier on around the development of indicators and the sort of lack of transparency around that, and the fact that I think it's the Scottish Government's chief statistician that's going to be pulling together those indicators. And it kind of strikes me a little bit that that's not only is the government marking its own homework, but it's also setting the questions. So it's creating indicators that match up with priorities. And there's a kind of potential there, I'm not suggesting that this is the case, but there's a potential there that they could choose indicators which match up with things that they know are progressing well. And I think it's really important that there is that oversight over the indicators and how important they actually are.
This is a bit like being at an auction, certainly if you twitch or touch your nose, you're going to get called to speak. But, I mean, one of the points I thought which was quite stark in your own submission was that over the last few years since the pandemic, the number of young people volunteering has fallen from 52 to 37%, which is quite a significant reduction. So how do you feel an indicator would help reduce increase the number of people who are actually volunteering, I should say?
So if you have an indicator, then that helps to we're talking about the purpose of the National Performance Framework. So if the National Performance Framework is acting as it should and it's informing the setting of policy and the setting of budgets and that kind of thing, then it could potentially identify that there's an issue there and identify that there's a need for additional resource to support that, which currently isn't there at the moment. So we... absolutely, so the fact that youth participation is declining even more starkly than adult participation is a real concern, considering that young people are the future, you know, the volunteers of the future. They're the ones that are going to be supporting our sort of service delivery in the future. One of the priorities that we've been working on recently is trying to get volunteering better recognised in education and skills reform, particularly through curriculum. So making sure that the benefits of volunteering and the importance of participating in volunteering are built into the curriculum. So if it's identified as an indicator, and we also suggested in our submission that there should be an indicator around under the education and skills outcome as well, that would help to identify if that performance is declining, then there's a need for additional resource to support that and try and reverse the trend.
Thank you. Now, the indicator on housing, this is the last indicator I'm going to touch on, given how time is moving forward, and I want everyone to have an opportunity to round up their comments. But the housing indicator says we live in safe, high-quality and affordable homes that meet our needs. We heard in the previous session about very high-quality but not particularly affordable housing that one local authority is providing. But how can we, with the resources available, maximise that indicator, Alan?
I will be 100% perfectly honest and say that housing is not necessarily an area that's of strong policy awareness for me. So.
Specifically within the kind of people, you know, the Alliance consider, the vulnerable kind of groups that you deal with?
I suppose that the one thing that would be useful is to give consideration to the kind of housing that we're building, is not just the affordability. So, for example, we often talk about the adaptations for housing. So housing needs to be, when we're building housing, it needs to be in the longer term, it needs to be adaptable for people's changing needs, because people, as they go through their life, they might experience changes, their disability, they might not have previously been disabled, they might become disabled, or their condition might progress. And rather than having quite costly and potentially often quite distressing process of having to find new housing or being turfed out, building sort of good quality housing that's easy to adapt is something that would be quite important. And it's also, I suppose, a case of building that in from the get-go, because there's a lot of money needed for retrofit. That's obviously very important because we've got a lot of good quality housing stock that needs to be improved. But if we're still doing new builds and they're not sort of designed to be accessible into the longer term, we're probably setting ourselves up for bother further down the line. I suppose that would be one area of importance for us in housing, is to make sure that we're, I suppose, measuring and sort of being clear that we need to build housing that is accessible and or can be adapted.
I've put an amendment which was accepted by the government, not committee, I have to say, but certainly later on in stage three, on adaptability. I'm just wondering what progress has been made in terms of housing becoming more adaptable than perhaps it was prior to that legislation.
I mean, I think we're definitely seeing some degree of progress in terms of the kinds of builds, but not, again, it's not an area of strength for my particular focus of working the line, so I couldn't give you any examples at the moment, I'm afraid. Yeah.
OK, no, that's fine. Carmen, I saw you making notes. I wonder if you were wanting to come in.
I'm making notes to do my own research.
Oh, no, that's OK, that's fine. OK, then, folks, we've covered it, I think, quite comprehensively, but there's always areas that we could have a greater focus on. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to give you, each of our guests, an opportunity to think about any final comments they wish to make about the National Performance Framework and where we go from here. The last person I'm going to ask to speak will be Shoba, because she spoke first. So you'll have the final word. So of the remaining four guests, who wants to go first? Sarah.
I think one point that's maybe not been touched on today, but I think is incredibly important, is the potential of the national outcomes and the National Performance Framework to make decision-making more approachable and transparent for decision-makers, which is something that's been a considerable challenge. So I'm the Policy Officer for Volunteer Scotland. Volunteering touches on many policy areas, and it can be particularly challenging to identify who in the government is the best person to speak to about that. So I think there's something about the national outcome. I mean, there's a wider point just around government transparency, but I think that there's potential with the national outcomes and the National Performance Framework to recognising that there are kind of key themes. If you've got a lead contact or a lead team for each of these sort of outcome areas, which can then help organisations like ourselves and other stakeholders to participate in policy and decision making, I think that would be a really positive step.
Okay, thanks very much, Dave. Adam?
Probably I'd echo that too. I think to be a true framework, it needs to fill out the gaps. It needs to be comprehensive in its implementation. It needs to understand how policy and budget setting are part of that process to achieve what we all collectively want to achieve. And I think it needs to connect with the other existing processes. I think this morning you talked about the local government benchmarking framework. There's no mention or connection to that existing framework, and there's bound to be other frameworks, not just within government, but in sectors, that it really needs to map and be a framework that connects all those elements. And that would make it a very, very powerful tool. Thank you.
Alan?
Yeah, I suppose just briefly, just to re-emphasise, we really do think that the National Performance Framework does have like quite a lot of strengths, that could be, if it's used properly, it could be done really well. And we certainly think that some of the changes that have been put forward, particularly around the national outcome on care, are very, very good. And if sort of applied properly, will lead to significant improvements. And particularly as I often talk about, the Alliance often calls for like a human rights approach to budgeting, If this framework is applied well, again, that could live up to, that could help us reach that standard of taking a human rights budgeting approach, because so much of this relates to people's basic sort of human rights. So we really welcome this being embedded. But that is the thing. It needs to have teeth. It needs to be well embedded. It needs to be consistently applied across government. I suppose we've had a bit of a discussion today about the fact that it's not necessarily consistently applied across government. And I suppose just to sort of touch on something that I know that the witnesses a couple of weeks ago talked about, which was the Wellbeing and Sustainable Development Bill. That's not been included in the programme for government, and there was perhaps a bit of a missed opportunity there, because that was perhaps an opportunity to more embed the national outcomes in sort of the framework for how the country works, and to take those opportunities to perhaps use that bill to amend other pieces of legislation and make it so that the national performance framework is that the various different bodies have a duty to comply with it, not simply to give it due regard. So I think that's perhaps a slightly missed opportunity that we're not going to get in this term now.
Okay, thank you. Carmen?
I would agree with that, and I would agree with Sarah as well about transparency and the national outcomes to increase transparency and accountability as well. Very important that there is no silo thinking when it comes to implementation, and that these national outcomes help policymakers to kind of speak to each other and for policy to be more coherent. And then finally, again, going back to the point of indicators, I think it would be very important, part of the success, or to be able for us to be able, for all of us to be able to measure progress, we will have to have a look at the indicators to see exactly what they are measuring, and it would be very welcome to have an opportunity to feedback to those indicators.
Thank you very much. And last but not least, Shoba.
Thank you. I'll begin with one of the issues that we didn't touch upon, which is linking the national performance framework with existing sectoral frameworks. So, for instance, there's the population health framework. That's the omnibus big ticket item that's under development. And so that needs to be linked with this so that there's implementation of that, which contributes to the national performance and well-being. And I would want to reinforce what I said before in terms of including strong local levers that empower local authorities to take decisions that are promoting well-being and productivity. And lastly, there's more a comment on the process, and it came up in what Sarah and Alan mentioned in terms of indicators not being available. So, there's an indication that the indicators would be developed once the national outcomes are adopted, but we have no sense of timelines. And so even in the issues that we deal with, we don't know, for instance, there would be an indicator on childhood obesity, which is a commitment that Scottish Government has made to have childhood obesity. So in terms of process, that would be a feedback that we would give, both in terms of the timelines and if there would be a consultation on the indicators once they're available. So those were my top thoughts.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Thank you for that, and thank you to all our guests for your contributions today. We will conclude our national outcome scrutiny with evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Economy next week. I now close the public part of this meeting. I'll ask members to stay behind for a brief discussion in private, but I'll just have a 2-minute break to allow the official report and broadcasting to leave, and your guests to leave. Thank you.